Don't make me horny right away.
I can't.
I thought that was your default state.
No, it usually takes about 10 minutes to get me going, but it's just, we're off to a good start.
Hey everybody, welcome to Funk Dunk, the podcast which has now been name dropped one time on a real podcast. Yay. And I'm kind of proud of that. like usual, I'm Sean. I'm joined with the dark and mysterious doctor of questions with a bachelor's in online smut, Jade. Say hello, Jade.
Should we do Star Wars names this week? And I'll just be Darth Mara Jade.
And, okay, yeah, Jade just wants to talk over me and totally not let me introduce my other co-host.
Mm-hmm. No, she wants a Star Wars name is the thing.
Rude.
Yeah, you asked me to respond and I responded.
I said say hello.
And I had other things I needed to say in addition to hello.
You will do what you are told, young lady. Or I will turn this podcast around and we are not going to the fun town, okay? We are not. You will not get to ride on the log flume.
I don't like the log flume.
Heathen.
Yeah. I don't like rides.
I hate it when my parents fight.
How can you not like the log flume? Especially during the summer, me and my friends would go to Funtown, go on the log flume, sit in the front, so we just get soaked when I did the, went down the really big incline, and then immediately run over and get on Excalibur, and it would just cool us right off, because like, you're going really fast on the roller coaster, and you're completely drenched. Oh, it's the best.
Mm.
Are you saying you had fun before? Like, in your life?
Well, this is before I met you two.
Okay.
So, I was a different person. I smiled sometimes. It was weird.
Mind blown. Mm. Seriously.
Sean Origins.
All right, anyway, Kirstine. How is Kirstine doing?
Not at all, actually.
You are doing not at all.
Pretty lifeless, yeah. But I'm relying on you guys to cheer me up, so just get started.
Mm. You're fucking boned.
Do funny stuff. Come on.
Mm. I'll do my best. So do we just want to dive into questions? Or?
That might be the best idea you've had ever.
Jay's really excited about the questions.
I am. I said so on Twitter. I woke up an hour early this morning, and I was just so excited I couldn't sleep, so I started getting ready for this podcast.
You prepared?
That might be why I'm a little sleepy now.
Oh, God. But we're going to get slaughtered.
It'll be fun. I'll make it pleasant. So anyway, this week is our Star Wars Super Special that I've been promising for a long time. So we're going to kick it off with all the questions that aren't about Star Wars.
Did we have a vote on if this is actually the Star Wars Super Special, or...
Well, Jade's Star Wars Corner has been a long time coming, and it seemed like timing it with the release of the new movie is the best
of course
option.
Or we could just vote you and just not do anything Star Wars related and just talk, like, nothing but, I don't know, just our opinions of various size penises.
Yeah, the thing is...
just cock talk.
That would be probably lots of fun, but... I watched a movie for this, so yes, I did.
What movie?
The movie.
Oh, wow.
Rogue One.
Awesome.
Oh.
I watched it yesterday.
I thought you meant Porky's 2 the next day.
Wait, what is that? I'm going to watch it.
It's the rather crap sequel to the classic teen sex comedy Porky's.
Porky's. Porky's is like, okay, writing it down. We'll talk about that next week.
All right, you watch Porky's.
I watch Porky's. And I actually did yesterday when you guys were talking about the Funky Shack anime.
Mm.
I was actually watching Rogue One illicitly.
Oh.
you cheated?
I did.
Doesn't matter.
Can't be arsed to go out to go outside for this.
Still saw the movie.
To be fair, I kind of did the same thing. I didn't pay to see it.
Okay, so. Cool, yeah. No, the thing is, if I watch it in German, there might be, because they only show German stuff, German dubbed stuff in the theaters, and there might be some kind of dissonance there. we talk about performance and stuff like that. So, of course, that's the only reason why I had to, you know, do crime.
And it's like in the German version, I'm just envisioning Darth Vader having a really high-pitched, squeaky voice.
Actually, it's pretty similar, but good guess. Oh my god, that would be so awesome. There's probably a fan dub.
Hmm.
There was one I saw on Facebook that dubbed all of Vader's lines from the first Star Wars with this like foul-mouthed British comic.
Hmm.
You know, like lines from the show this guy was on, and it just like basically, you know, can't remember. I know he used the C word a lot. And Darth Vader calling Leia a cunt is really worth the price of admission.
What is that?
Because that's his daughter, yo.
Is that... Wait, did you say that's on YouTube? Or where did you...
It was on... I saw it on Facebook, actually.
Oh, okay. So it might not be that easy to find.
It might not. Or then again, it might. I mean, who the fuck knows?
Nobody.
Okay, so questions?
Let Jade do the questions, please. Yeah, she won't shut up about it.
Let's get this started so we can get to the good stuff. I brought pictures to show you.
What?
When we get to the questions that need pictures.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Do it. So,
Oh, wait, actually, I want to know if it was called Snatch Wars.
Awesome.
Writing it down.
I just found the video.
Nice.
All right.
Okay, so Revan asks, favorite board game? Probably Clue.
If you're talking about...
I guess.
Oh, God, there are a lot of good ones. That's the problem. Like, does Scrabble count as a board game?
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
Scrabble would have to go in there because I'm like I'm a word nerd, you know, so I love that sort of thing. But then there's other ones like Munchkin. Munchkin is such a great way to lose friends. Like, the best way to lose friends. So I remember playing Munchkin with a group of my friends, and just because it was the most advantageous move possible for like four turns in a row, we just fucked over my friend Tim to the point where he goes, "Oh, sure, it's just fuck with Timmy Day," and he stormed away from the table. It was great. Then there's also Call of Cthulhu, which is such a fun board game, and you can buy expansion packs that make the board bigger, which is cool, because more of an RPG / board game, and it's really fun.
Hmm.
But I can't pick.
Yeah, I didn't know that one was a board game. I knew it was an RPG, but...
Yeah.
They're separate. They're an RPG system, and there's also a board game.
Oh, okay.
The board game is out, they're like, well, they're related because they're the same, like, mythos, but the board game plays out a lot, you know, like a regular board game, but with RPG elements.
Oh.
And you're all, like, working together to try to get the secrets eventually, either A, prevent an Elder God from being resurrected, or if he is actually brought back, somehow managing to kill the Elder God, which we've actually done.
Huh.
But it's like, ridiculously hard. You gotta get so lucky with the rolls. But you actually can. We killed, what was his name? Big Yellow Bastard.
Yeah, I don't know the colors of them based on the stories. There's Cthulhu, Nyarlathotep, Azathoth, the fungi from Yith, or Yagoth, I think. My Lovecraft encyclopedia is not far away, but I don't feel like grabbing it. I do want to play that game, though, once I can get some meat space friends together.
Yeah, it's the thing.
Yeah, you need friends to play board games, and we're just lonely internet nerds.
Kind of makes me want to, you know people. I hope that blows over soon.
Mm.
Wanting to know people?
Mm-hmm. It's terrible.
Mm.
Mm.
Yeah. Also, hungry hippos.
Mm. Until the hippos all get stuck together from slamming the buttons too much. Maybe that's awesome. Just the portable version. I don't know.
Also, as an aside, I just googled out of curiosity what this game is called that I used to play a lot in English, so I can mention it. It's called Ludo. It's just, you know that. It's the simplest game in the world, but it's a lot of fun.
It sounds familiar.
Whatever. Yeah, anyway, it's not the point. The thing is, this website is called Good Question, and I found it there. So there's how is that game called in English? And in the sidebar, there is users recommend other questions, right? Users recommend masturbation, no arousal, do I have a disease, female 14. So I don't know how that's related, but just as just an aside. Okay. Go on.
Now, the board game I was thinking of actually was called Arkham Horror.
Oh, okay. Sounds familiar.
Yeah, it is so much fun. You get like three or four people to, I think it's like four or five people. I usually played it with four people, and it's an incredibly good
board game. Is that the sequel to Arkham Asylum?
Could be.
No, but if it had Batman in it, it would be even cooler. Or if Batman was like an older god?
I actually have a Batman comic called The Doom that came to Gotham. It's it's like a Batman in like early 1900s Lovecraft times, and it's a Lovecraft story with Batman. It was pretty good. I'll have to read it again sometime.
You know the interesting thing about H.P. Lovecraft was he was like just the most racist.
Yep.
Like, you learn that if you actually read his actual work.
Well, like any of the letters he sent to people, especially.
Yeah. Like, I even remember the one, The Rats in the Walls, which is one of his more classic stories. And the main character has a cat.
Yeah.
Do you know what the cat's name is?
I do know what the cat's name is.
Does Kirstein know what the cat's name is?
Of course not.
It's a black cat, one thing.
Mm-hmm. And the cat's name is Nigger Man.
Yep.
Kind of has a ring to it, doesn't it?
It kind of does.
I mean, it was also early 1900s, so...
Yeah, so everyone was kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah, but he was like very, very against race mixing. That was like a great horror to him. He believed a lot in racial purity and stuff. Oh, man.
He was a fan of Hitler at the time.
Yeah. He was just all the racist, but it's kind of sad because even the stories that don't, you know, there isn't like a big racial undertone to them, there is. You just have to look for it sometimes.
Yeah, like, I didn't think in his stories it's as explicit. Like, in his letters, it's definitely there. In the stories, it's like, it's subtle enough that you can still enjoy the story without thinking this guy's human trash. But
yeah, but there's still always that little undercurrent. But, you know, I mean, like you said, the stories themselves are masterfully written and are just so...
Yeah, like...
You know, like I said, they're some of the most important and influential works of fiction in the modern era.
Yeah, I mean, it's like the inspiration for most modern horror in there. It's like that... And Mary Shelley's Frankenstein are just like the origin of most modern horror stories.
Yeah.
I mean, there were times when everyone was a shithead. So is it really fair to just pick out one guy and, you know?
Well, he was a very outspoken shithead about his shitheadedness.
Well, he was also like super, like, at least the impression I get of him, he was like super closeted. He, like, I think he lived with his mom and aunt for most of his life.
Yeah.
I don't know. He was a weird guy.
And also, like, pretty much never made real money off of his stories. He sold them for, the only place would publish them, bought them for just, like, fucking pennies on the dollar. That's why he lived with his mom his whole life, was he couldn't support himself as an author.
Yeah.
Get a real job, hippie.
Yeah. Poor Lovecraft.
Aww.
I don't know.
Poor white supremacist horror writer.
I'm super excited for, like, Alan Moore's been doing a Lovecraft series called Providence. I talked about it in the reading thread once. It's up to issue 11 now, and my pre-order for issue 12 just went through, so in a month or two, that'll be coming out, and I'm super excited, because, seems like Cthulhu's gonna finally be rising to take over the world.
God, finally!
Just something they hinted at the end of Neonomicon. There's this woman who's pregnant with Cthulhu, and it seems like he's finally going to be born now at the end of this series.
Sounds kind of unpleasant.
Mm.
But he'll just be a baby Cthulhu, so
well,
I'm curious
to see how they do it, because he's...
squiggly tentacles.
The whole concept of time has been really weird in this series. It's like Cthulhu's birth happened in the past, but it's happening in the future. So, yeah. So, okay, next question. Is the Voldemort rule correct, meaning should you stop talking about evil to not give it power attention? I think you should talk about it. I think, you know, everything should be talked about. It doesn't mean that I'm necessarily personally going to talk about you-know-who. I find the thought of talking about you-know-who pretty depressing, but I think stuff like that should be discussed.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely discuss it. You can give it any name you want.
Yeah, I mean, you shouldn't be ignored by everyone, I think. I mean, it's understandable if you need to ignore something for your own sanity, but...
I find people who do the whole argument that mentioning an evil, you know, gives it power, tend to be people who enjoy that evil and just don't want anyone to criticize them for it.
Mm.
You know, like, I'm at the age where a lot of my friends are turning really old and shitty. Like, people who used to be cool anti-establishment people who are my friends because we were all cool anti-establishment people are now, like, posting memes making fun of millennials for being lazy and are, like, talking about how, you know, raising the minimum wage, we shouldn't do that. The kids just go to school and get degrees instead. And doesn't it sound like all the square old people we hated growing
up? It's a circle of life.
And still hate.
Yeah. And one of them actually posted a thing about how it was such bullshit that he was accused of having white nonsense because he said that he was color, that he didn't see race, and if people just stopped talking about our differences, then we'd all be equal. And it's like, dude, that's what racists say when people call them out on being racist. They say, oh, I don't see race. And you bring up racism, that only propagates racism. If no one mentioned racism, there'd be no racism. And like, dude, you sound like the worst, just the absolute worst.
Those are two different things. If he says, don't bring up race, like in don't treat people differently, those are two different things.
But what he's also saying is basically he's denying the validity that people who grow up in the U.S. at least, who are different races, have different life experiences. And therefore, discussing that is perfectly valid.
Sure.
And also saying that, you know what, a middle-class white dude probably doesn't quite understand the plight of an inner-city black person quite as well as an inner-city black person does, you know. But he's basically saying that calling him out for, you know, his kind of shittiness on this issue is like just causing the shittiness. It's like, no. It's like saying that, you know, my arm really hurts. It's not that I broke my arm, it's a fucking cast that's annoying me, you know?
Hmm.
And I just think that the people who want us to say, you know, if you talk about it, you're giving it power. Again, those are people who, generally speaking, they want to be shitty, and they don't want to ever be called out for being shitty. So
yeah,
that could be.
That's my rant on the subject.
Okay, so next question, more fun question: favorite mode of transportation apart from piggyback rides?
But that's not fair.
Yeah, well, we don't want to break Sean's back, so we can't do piggyback on him.
I don't know, Jade, you're not, like, the biggest person. I probably could give you a piggyback ride. It's not a very long one.
Even with your back problems?
Oh.
Yeah, as long as I, like, you know, distributed the weight properly.
Okay. I'll look forward to that. Favorite mode of transportation? That's pretty open. Can I say jetpack?
Do you have to have experienced it?
Yeah. Because,
and I guess if it's experience, I rode on a train once, not a subway, like an actual train, and that was pretty nice.
Is that not a huge thing?
No, not
for you guys.
Here. No, we hardly have any trains.
US.
Oh, really? Here it's just lousy with trains. So,
yeah, it would be nice if we had more trains because they're, you know, more convenient. But
I hate them.
The car economy has taken over America, so it's all cars and roads everywhere.
Hmm. Yeah, there's a train station in every fucking backwater town, so.
Yeah, here, if you're going to take a train somewhere, you actually have to drive to get to the train.
Yeah.
Very cool.
That doesn't sound ridiculous.
Yeah, because I had to drive to the train station. I rode it down to Boston with some friends, and then we walked around Boston and then walked back to the train and then rode back to the train stop where we got in our cars.
I mean, yeah, that's of course, there's, I mean, those backwater towns that have train stations probably don't have bus or other public transportation. So, yeah, that's, of course, you need a car or at least a bike to get mm-hmm. there, which is, yeah, okay. But do you guys know Segways?
Yeah.
Like the...
Yep. I've never ridden one, but yeah.
No, me neither, but I want to. They look so, so stupid and so ridiculous. I really want to just cruise around my town, like, waving at people that I don't know. Because that's, I think, part of the fun is like a helmet and...
it's just a stick with wheels.
Okay, now I'm envisioning you like riding a Segway, but like dressed, decked out in full motorcycle leathers.
Yeah.
You know, just like a skull and crossbones. Just like looking as badass and terrifying as possible, except for the fact you're on a Segway.
And there's like, rig it up so that there's fire shooting out of the back end and all that stuff. Yeah. That's great.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, at that point, really, you could just like use a hoverboard. Eventually, fire will shoot out of it.
Oh, yeah. I want to try that.
The natural course of it. One of the best things I ever saw was a vine of Mike Tyson using a hoverboard. And just falling flat on his face.
Do these things actually hover these days? I'm not informed.
No, they're like, basically they're a Segway without the stick part.
That's a skateboard.
No, like because it's got the wheels on the sides. Yeah.
Oh, all right, I won't, yeah, you know. I don't.
And also technology. They catch fire.
Mm-hmm.
They catch fire.
So that's the most important part.
Well, last time I went to Utah, actually, in the announcements, they made sure to mention that you could not bring a Segway on the plane in any form, even in your checked luggage, because they can catch fire when just chilling out.
A Segway or a hoverboard?
A hoverboard, okay. I mean, sorry. My bad. I fucked it up. I made a mistake on a podcast.
Oh, no. There's a good... So they're so super common these days that you have to actually worry about that. I mean...
Yeah. But I was trying to think of a favorite mode of transportation.
Oh, also, dolphin.
Hmm.
That would be pretty cool, I guess.
Yeah, but then you get to give the dolphin a handjob at the end. That's kind of weird.
Yeah, that's the point.
Yeah, that's the fun part.
Yeah, my favorite mode of transportation is kind of a toss-up. Because one is extremely common and one's kind of rare in the U.S. Extremely common. I honestly love airplanes. I love flying in airplanes. The part I love the most is the very start.
Mm-hmm.
You're on the runway, and you're in this huge metal tile with all those wings, and you're packed in like a fucking sardine. And then it starts going forward, and the jet engines kick in. And then you watch as the ground falls away. And it's a moment where it's almost like you're going, like the entire human race is just giving the middle finger to the laws of physics and being like, gravity schmavity, wee! We're going to make metal fly. And it's empowering as a human to watch as this airplane you're in does stuff that it really feels like should be physically fucking impossible.
Yeah.
And I love that feeling.
Flying in itself is super cool, but you ever went through a storm?
Yep. Oh, many times.
Oh, fuck.
I was actually on a tiny red-eye commuter jet flying back from Washington, D.C. one time by myself because it was my sister's college graduation, but I still had high school shit I had to deal with. So I went down, but my mom and grandmother went down for like a week, and I went down for the weekend just to be there for the graduation. And I'm flying back. We hit a storm, and there's a businessman, maybe two rows ahead of me on the other side of the aisle, because it's only two seats per side, tiny little airplane. And we hit turbulence, and he has right when he had just gotten a drink. It was like in a, it was in a short round tumbler. It was like I don't know, it looked like a brandy of some kind. It was golden colored. I'll never forget this because all of a sudden we lost like 20 feet in a second. And I watched as the liquid in his glass hovered in midair about 3 inches above his glass for a second before splashing down all over him.
Oh God.
That was wonderful. It was beautiful. I think he got a free drink.
Hope
Because
so.
there's no physical way he could have not lost his drink because it was hovering in midair above the glass.
Sounds pretty cool, yeah.
So, it was so good. Yeah, and I remember one time going to Utah. There were really bad thunderstorms in Atlanta, so we actually had to circle the Atlanta airport during the thunderstorm because it was too dangerous to land for like an hour. And just driving in circles in a thunderstorm.
Oh,
I
it's
don't know how
great.
that was safer than trying to land, but apparently it is. And someone on the forum is going to be like, "Yeah, well, obviously there's a reason."
Oh, sure.
So that was kind of neat. Well, the problem with air travel, though, is sometimes it leads to situations like a couple of years ago, a storm delayed my flight out of Portland, and by the time I got to my connecting flight in Philadelphia, I'd missed my flight, and the earliest flight they could get, and it was like, I don't want to say it was like 9:45, and the earliest flight they'd get me on was 8 a.m. So like 12, almost 12 hours later. And so I just cool my heels overnight, all night in this place. And get this wonderful thing. Everything closed at 10. So I'm stuck in a closed airport with no food and no way of getting food. And the only place that was even still open when I finally realized I'm stuck here was a bar. They weren't serving food anymore, and I had time to get one pint of beer, thinking, okay, at least it has calories in it. And then I proceeded to derp away on my computer for 11 hours,
Oh.
or 10 hours, and every, I think it was 45 minutes, I had to reconnect to the internet and watch a small advertisement to continue getting free Wi-Fi. It was
It's fun
it was a time, definitely a time.
that you had, that you spent.
Yeah, it was a thing that happened. My other favorite form of transportation, though, I just want to get this in there, is the Utah Tracks system. It goes through Salt Lake City, and it goes to all of the suburbs too. And it's basically automated electronic trains that you literally don't need to own a car if you live in Salt Lake City because Trax goes everywhere. It has its own lanes in most of the roads, so you all, there's not a, doesn't really like hold up traffic. And here, this is so Mormon. It's on the honor system,
Oh no.
like the fares. There's a machine. You type in where you want to go. It chart tells you what the fare is. You put your money in. It gives you a ticket. I've been to Utah like 7 or 8 times, something like that. And I've used Trax every single time. And we've paid every single time. And I've never had anyone check my ticket. You can literally just step on the train and go somewhere for free.
You think that's weird? That's the way it is around here too. There's just like these machines. There's no one selling you a ticket, like a person selling you a ticket. What for?
No, I mean, there's also no one to check that you have
There's
one.
probably people who check, but you never ran into one, I'm
Now,
assuming.
theoretically, they can have someone check, I guess. But if they do check and they find that you don't have a ticket, All they do is at the next stop, they kindly ask you to purchase a ticket for the remainder of your journey.
Oh, okay.
But I've never run into a ticket
Oh,
checker.
here you get a fine, so.
Nope, they just politely ask you to pay for the rest of the journey. It's like it's the weirdest
Oh, that's
shit.
so nice.
Honestly, it's a really nice form of transportation. I mean, the trains are all super clean. The stations are all super nice. The train rides very smooth. It's always on time because it's fucking automated. And just a really great and easy way to get around Salt Lake City and its suburbs.
Welcome to Dry Funk.
So I think for the next question, it'd be funny if we just do a lightning round answer on it. So, what is the greatest
Okay.
invention of mankind?
Dildos.
There we go.
I was gonna say that. You just got to me
That
first.
is that in my I mean it's just the perfect idea.
Can't get enough dicks. I need some fake dicks.
It's also one of the oldest ideas, because like they found Stone Age dildos, like caveman
There's
dongs.
probably not sanitary.
Probably nothing was sanitary back then, so I don't think it would really matter.
Okay.
I think everyone had an infection down there like 24/7, because
Okay. That's it.
what are they gonna do? Oh, it's your period. Here, shove this like groundhog up there. That'll help.
Okay, you are
Okay.
in some kind of Mad Max apocalypse. What would your gang be called? What would their gimmick or heraldry? Okay, I don't know. What's your Mad Max apocalypse gang?
Us?
Good answer.
No, that's not true. Because Kerstin is so far away that if the apocalypse did happen, and it will, then how the hell would we get to Austria in order to team up with her? I don't think it's gonna
If the
happen.
apocalypse happened, I'd blow my brains out as soon as I got a gun, so you'd be alone.
Yeah, see, you're no use to me. I know exactly what my apocalypse crew, who they would be and what they would be called. They would be the Blue House crew. Which is this group of guys who I am a member of going way back. It was actually the named after the house where we all would hang out and party, and it's where I stayed most of the time when I was actually homeless for 5 months. That was my most frequent place to stay. And there's several reasons that they would be my crew. Reason number one is they own a lot of guns, and that's very useful. Reason two is that several of them are ridiculously strong, like friggin' weightlifter guys. And number three is they have all the drugs and alcohol, which would really make the apocalypse more entertaining and better. And seriously, if you ever met my buddy John, you would not fuck with him
Is that
because he.
the guy whose house we're gonna wreck at the when we have the Shack convention?
Oh,
Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
that one.
His current hot place, yeah. And he's one of those guys that, like, he's very, super friendly, super gentle. He's got a little, like, a 6-year-old son who he dotes over. But at the same time, one time, he killed a deer with his bare hands.
Manly.
He was driving. No, he wasn't driving. That's right. Because he was drunk at the time. His friend was driving. And they like had to come to a screeching halt because they almost hit a deer. And John just like gets in his head and goes, "I'm gonna catch that deer," and just jumps out of the car and goes running off into the woods, totally unarmed, middle of winter. Like 10 minutes later, he comes back dragging the deer's carcass. He literally chased a deer into the woods, killed it with his bare hands, and dragged it back to his truck. That's the type of guy you want on your side in the apocalypse.
I suppose.
Yeah, I mean it sounds practical, but I don't know. I'm not sure if I want to associate with deer killers. Just
You're gonna have to kill in the apocalypse. It's gonna be eat or be eaten, yo.
no, because my gang is the fuck this shit gang, and we just
Will you join my suicide cult and just kill ourselves when the apocalypse happens?
I mean, it kind of depends on what kind of apocalypse it is. Like, zombie apocalypse? No,
Oh, yeah, I mean, at least a zombie apocalypse, you'd probably still have electricity. I think once the lights go out and the internet goes out, I'm just out.
I don't know anything about Mad Max, so I don't know what kind of apocalypse that is.
It's a nuclear apocalypse.
Yeah, I mean, Mad Max is kind of vague. Like, it could be nuclear. It could, like, in the earlier movies, they said it was something like a gas crisis where, like, they ran out of gasoline, so cars couldn't run, so everything went to shit. But it's pretty much your standard. I mean, like, the aesthetic of Mad Max post-apocalypse is that there's, like, gangs on either motorcycles or vehicles or stuff, and they all have, like, it kind of looks like Fallout, the video game. Just that kind of cobbled together from pieces of trash costumes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know what I would do. Just hang out, wait what happens? I have no idea.
Mm. I might start swimming for Austria. Maybe that would give me something to do.
I mean, if it was Waterworld or something, I would just, you know, would just do a lot of synchronized swimming to pass the time. But in just the, you know, everything is just trash apocalypse. I don't know. There's a lot of fun apocalypses. This sounds pretty boring, actually.
Mm. So, okay, so we've got more questions. Eugene T., our sharpest knife, asks, do you understand Esperanto? Have you tried? It's based mostly on Germanic languages. So I guess that would be for you.
English is also Germanic language.
I don't think I've ever heard Esperanto, so I don't know.
I don't understand it. I haven't tried, but it sounds interesting, I guess.
Mm.
The universal language approach seems like it could solve a lot of problems.
I've only heard Esperanto butchered by the character Rimmer in Red Dwarf, because learning it is a way he could get a promotion, so him and Lister wouldn't be the same rank anymore. And he, of course, when he speaks it, he just mispronounces everything horrendously because he's Rimmer and his whole gimmick is he's an amazing loser. So I've never heard it said properly.
Mm.
It's just made up anyway. It's just... it's bullshit. So
aren't all languages made up?
Yeah, but...
Yeah, I mean, you have to get a lot of people to agree to speak them for it to be a language. Mm. Otherwise, it's just code words.
It's just bullshit.
Klingon's a language.
Yeah, and Tolkien's Elvish is a language, but...
Elvish, yeah.
I was about to say, yeah, totally languages. Spoken by more people than Esperanto.
It's true.
Yeah, but they're dead languages because nothing's getting added to them. But
Sanskrit?
Eugene has a second question that's more personal, I guess. If you had to learn another language, which one? And he's got bets on the answers, so I'm not going to say Japanese, even though that's the correct answer for me.
You just did, though, really, you did say it would be Japanese, and therefore you answered the question.
Well, yeah, but I'm going to give my official answer as German. I don't know. Why not?
Let me teach you.
Please do.
It would be horrible.
Yeah, I got bored while learning Japanese was fun, but there's so much to learn, and trying to do it just by myself is kind of boring.
I was going to teach you how to curse properly.
Oh, that'd be good.
Sign language.
Ooh.
Does it count?
It should, because
it's really useful.
I do, because of my job. I interact with deaf people quite a bit.
Hmm.
So yeah, knowing sign language would actually be very useful for my day-to-day life.
Yeah. You know? I encountered that in the past as well, and as I always thought, man, should have learned that. Because I bet they're super happy when they run into somebody just randomly who can, you know sign language. It's probably not an everyday occurrence. And it's also, I think it's just useful all around. But it really, I think it's a lot of work.
So.
Mine, though, I'm not gonna say sign because I have one language I'd really like to learn before that, a foreign language, and that's English.
Yep.
I would love to learn how to speak English properly using the correct grammar rules and
I studied English for 4 years, so I could help you with that.
I would love to learn where to put the extra U's.
I'll show you my he I have a history of the English language textbook that explains
Of course you
how
do.
over the centuries English was like influenced by French because the French took over the English island and pretty much reshaped the language, which is why there's so many French words in English.
Oh, no, I have a giant book on the history of the English language. It's beautiful.
From the outside.
Yeah. But yeah, like I have coworkers who speak three or four or five different languages. And I'm just like, holy shit, that's so amazing. You speak all these different languages fluently, and I kind of speak pidgin English. That's about it.
I don't have a very good grasp on German either. So.
I mean, as far as I'm concerned with English, as long as you're intelligible, that's all that really matters. A lot of the rules are just there for nitpickers. Like, who really cares if you split an infinitive? It still makes sense as a phrase.
You're just trying to defend William Shatner, aren't you?
No, I just had a really chill professor who was like super cool. She just wanted to teach us stuff about like history of English and the history of words and like origins of words, and didn't really mind if there were like minor grammatical errors and stuff, because as far as she was concerned, as far as I'm concerned, like philosophically, the important thing about language is being understood and communicating meaning. So if you're doing that even by breaking the rules, as long as your meaning is clear, that's all that really matters.
So I should try to start making sure people understand what I say.
Yeah, just speak in a way that people know what you're saying.
I mean, you're halfway there.
What if I just speak in nothing but jive?
Try it. This is the best, platform to try out all your word crimes.
Yeah, that's what the podcast is for.
Just a training ground.
Okay, so Brent has a request for you, Kirsten. Why does Kirsten's voice sound like the doll from Bloodborne, and can she please say, "Farewell, good hunter, may you find your worth in the waking world," in a soft voice?
I didn't know what that was because it's a game, so of course.
Yeah, I haven't played it, but
Isn't that Dark Souls related? Is that the
I think it's either related or it's like a similar game. One of those brutally difficult games.
Right, so of course not. So of course I don't know it. And I looked it up, and I was expecting something extremely mean or horrible. But it's actually really nice. Thank you, Brent. It's a really pleasant voice. Why? I mean, I guess I have a theory that I'm like basically a reanimated corpse. So that's similar to a doll, I think.
Wait, so you're the zombie from the zombie apocalypse?
No, zombies are zombies yeah, I guess they can
Well,
be
I
just
mean, yeah, zombies
reanimated.
are kind of vague, but being undead seems to be the running theme in being a zombie.
I mean, either that or just a failed science experiment. I don't know what's going on there. So that's probably related to that in some way. And now I know what she sounds like, and I'm going to try to say this because I think she has an accent too. Let me just channel her. Should have rehearsed this. Farewell, good hunter. May you find your worth in the waking world. Okay.
Now that we're talking about Kirstine's voice, I was at work the other day, and there's this girl who works for us who is from Iraq. She grew up in Iraq. Probably I think she moved to the U.S. when she was 8 with her family. And she like one of my coworkers was leaving for the day, and she said, "Bye, have a nice day," to him, something like that. And I swear to God, it sounded just like Kirsten. It sounded just fucking like you. And I looked at her like, what the fuck? Why does this Iraqi girl sound like my Austrian friend? I don't understand this.
Did you go talk to her to find out if it just was just that one sentence or just in general?
No, I think in general it's just you both have the same kind of tone to your voices, you know, but it was uncanny how much she sounded like you.
We should get her on the podcast to fuck with people.
I don't think she'd actually enjoy the content of our podcast.
Oh, she's one of those normies, you're saying?
Let me put it this way. I was in our break room and there was a bug of some kind, and she's going, "Sean, stomp it." I'm like, "Okay, stomp it." And I lift up my foot and I didn't kill it all the way, so stomp it again. That's my foot. I start to walk away. Someone goes, "Sean is still alive." And it was still like a tenth of this bug was still on squish, and it was still trying to drag itself around. I just went, "Jesus fucking Christ!" and stomped it. And the look she gave me was a look
Oh.
of horror. How do you use those words?
Oh, okay.
Too innocent for us.
People, how do you live? How do you do it?
Sheltered.
Do you go through this world just like you're all pure and innocent? I don't get it.
I don't know, and it's really
I mean,
bad.
she's probably a whore in the bedroom.
I don't
There's
know.
always, those are, you know.
I don't. Is there like a Middle Eastern Muslim like sexual stereotype that I don't know about?
No, but one about, you know, shy, innocent people. I don't know about the other thing. I mean, I guess if you want, I can ask my neighbors. I have about like 8 or 9 or 10 Afghani and Syrian families living in my apartment complex, so I can ask them. I'm not sure if they would be
Yeah,
pleased with that.
just be like, hey, yo, yo, Omar, what's your life like in the sack? When the burqa comes off, does the sexy music come on?
I like to assume, you know, those girls need something to hope they have a good time in the, you know.
Yeah, probably. Okay, so next question is fun. Eugene asks, a Lola version of Mirren. Since it's Mirren, I assume he would have a palm tree for a dick with coconuts for his balls. You're welcome, Mirren.
Let's just leave it at that. I can't.
Okay, so Bright Marsh asks a poem. Titled An Ode to Something. What kink do you think will make Austin wink? Does he tend for brawny men? Does he fawn for Noonie and Khan? And he wants our answer to be in rhyme. Austin already answered about his fetishes. He said it was girls in glasses, I think.
Yeah, make it rhyme.
I'm not good at rhyming.
Wait, that would have to be a really big glass. Like, are we talking wine glass? Something fluted?
Well, maybe they're just
What it,
they're
what it?
crushed and liquefied and put in a glass.
Yeah, maybe, I guess. It just
Yeah, Austin is a special kind of cannibal.
seems like a lot of work.
He drinks his victims.
Yeah.
Exclusively the fluids.
Yeah, he just grinds them up, bones and all, into a pulp and puts it in his blender, makes a smoothie, and drinks it. Especially the girls, because that's what he's into.
No, I don't like the idea that he's actually he kills them. I think he's one of those cannibals who just like you know.
Yeah, he just finds a body by the side of the road.
No, they discussed that on the BT podcast. They're the kind of cannibal who just you know eats people's snot and various other fluids
Oh,
or
okay. So
toenails or
it's
stuff like
already
that.
canon.
I guess it didn't come from him, and he sort of denied or sort of refused to talk about it, which I take as a sign that, you know,
Yep, definitely
he
him.
doesn't wanna. Yep. There was no rhyme in there.
No, because okay, I'm bad at rhyming. I will never be a rap artist. I can't rhyme.
I don't spit my fat rhyme for free.
Not even for your podcast fans?
Hell no. Got to get paid, son.
Will you make a ringtone and then sell it?
No.
Oh.
I'm really just not a good person.
Okay, so that answers the question about Austin's kinks.
Okay. Austin likes girls in glasses and Sean passes on the yep. question, in parentheses.
Yay, we did the rhyme. And by we, I mean you.
All the time.
Okay, so are you ready?
For your slime?
No, no. Are you ready for these questions?
Sure.
Because it's time for Star Wars. Yep. Okay, so I figure with these, I'll just answer the ones that aren't, like, opinion questions. And then we can all answer the opinion questions, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So Bright Marsh has his usual pile of questions. Our pressure cunt of questions. Is that what we're calling him now?
I guess so.
Yes. Because he has a vice-like vagina.
He hasn't...
Unless he's gotten an upgrade.
Protested.
Yeah.
Already?
Not yet. Maybe. We'll see. Okay, well, this week he can be Darth Crusher, Cunt of the Sith. And he will... Let's see. His first question. Is the Starkiller base in reference to the Force Unleashed Starkiller? See, short answer, no. Long answer... In the original draft of Star Wars, there was a character called Luke Starkiller. The story was actually called The Adventures of Luke Starkiller is taken from the Journal of the Wills, which relates to Rogue One, the temple where Chirrut, the badass monk, hangs out, is the Temple of the Wills, which it's a reference to that original Star Wars script. But yeah, the name Starkiller comes from that original draft. It's been reused at least 3 times. Let's see, in Knights of the Old Republic, at the end of the gladiator fights, your final opponent is Bendix Starkiller. And then, of course, in The Force Unleashed, Vader's secret apprentice is named Starkiller. And then in The Force Awakens, they use the name again for the multi-shot Death Star. So it's just one of those words that gets thrown around as a constant reference. The Star Wars writers like to do that. Okay, so then he asks, is the holiday special canon? And I was thinking about that, and it's kind of complicated. Because, I mean, again, short answer, no. As far as I know, it's not canon. But the long answer is that before Disney took over, the way the canon system worked was that anything George Lucas had a direct hand in took precedence over things that he didn't. So, like, the movies and the Clone Wars TV show were considered a higher level of canon than everything else. So if they did anything to contradict, they overrode it. So I think, technically, I think George Lucas had a hand in the holiday special, which would make it more canon than most everything else. When Disney took over, what they said was that the movies are canon, the Clone Wars cartoon is canon, everything else is no longer canon. We will recycle parts of it as we see fit, but they threw it all out to start fresh and declared that every book, every boring-ass book they've published since they took over is now canon. But I don't know if the holiday special is included in movies and TV, because again, it's something that George Lucas had a hand in, so maybe it's canon?
The question is, does it matter?
Yeah, I mean, really, it only matters to nerds like me, and even to me, it doesn't matter. I don't know.
Nothing happens that would be, you know, I mean, does it matter whether, like, some fucking Wookiee on some fucking planet just farts? Is that important to, you know?
Yeah.
It really doesn't matter.
The only things about it that would make a difference in the canon is that Life Day exists, so the Star Wars form of Christmas is Life Day. Okay. Chewie's extended family exists. Han and Chewie went to go visit them once for Life Day. A bunch of weird stuff happened on the TV. Boba Fett's existence was predicted by a cartoon on the TV. Yeah, that's a fair point. There's not much of a plot to the holiday special, so who fucking cares? Did you catch the mouse droid in Rogue One? I didn't notice. I'm sure it was there, though. Mouse droids are everywhere. I don't know. Did either of you catch it?
What's that? Is that just a mouse that's a droid?
It's a little box on wheels that kind of rolls around, usually in Imperial bases, and it's a droid that carries messages, pretty much. I guess secret messages that you can't send through a regular communicator, so they stuff them in this little box droid and let it roll its way through the hallways. Mm-hmm. I didn't notice it, but I guess everybody got excited because it's something that also showed up in A New Hope. I didn't notice, I didn't care. Rogue One has lots of references to A New Hope. I'm sure that was one of them. Did Rogue One have a Wilhelm scream?
Yes.
You did?
Yep. It's a background Wilhelm scream. It's a little bit hard to hear, but I want to say it's when the scene that leads up to having the dad die.
Okay, on Edu, I think the planet was called.
Yeah, I'm bad with names and shit. But Jin is like sneaking, you know, onto the platform and shit. And
spoilers.
Right when she gets on
her. Oh, with the guy that she pulled off the edge?
The guy she pulled off the edge and throws him, he does a Wilhelm scream. Okay. It's faint. You really have to be almost looking for it to hear it. But that dude, yeah, that she grabs from behind and throws him off the edge, he does a Wilhelm scream. So.
Okay. What is that? What is that? I don't know what that is.
It's a scream that they've used in like every Star Wars movie, every Indiana Jones movie, and a lot of other modern action movies, because I think Star Wars and Indiana Jones are the ones who started really pushing it as like an Easter egg.
Yeah.
What does it sound like? Do it.
I think it'd be easier just to put in a sound clip of it, because...
No. I wanted one of you to do it.
I'll let Sean. I'm not...
I could just YouTube it.
You could.
Who cares? No, do it.
Okay, fine. If Sean's not going to do it, something like...
Ah! Oh.
Yeah, it's like a high-pitched kind of ow sound.
I wouldn't know that from any other scream.
Now, it's very particular. Like, once you've heard it enough times, you recognize it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so, let's see. Doesn't Satoichi, by which he means cheer it, he has a name, Brightmarsh, doesn't Satoichi cheer it sound like Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged Darts?
It's been too fucking long since I saw that.
Yeah, I still haven't watched Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged, so I don't know.
Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged was the first Abridged series I got into, but then his, release schedule got really, really choppy, especially with the whole getting married and then getting divorced like 3 months later thing that he did. And I think I had actually stopped watching by the time that would have been something I'd heard of. Mm. I mean, I'm still like, I'm so bad at watching things. I'm like, still like probably 10 or 11 episodes of DBZ Abridged back, you know? Mm. And I've really liked DBZ Abridged has been consistently good. Mm. Whereas Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged had up and down episodes. Yeah. Though there still has some things that were really brilliant that I actually still use in regular conversation and no one gets the joke.
Yeah.
It's fun. Like, when he had Tristan Taylor was handed something and just goes, "This is going right up my nose." I still use that one, and I'm friends with Spider-Man. Just little quotes. And also his one with Bakura going, "I'm not gay, I'm British."
I remember that. I don't remember much from that series, but
the thing with the Brothers Paradox, he goes, do you think these might be the gay people? They're the distinct possibility.
Oh, good stuff. Good stuff.
And also the only other one that I still use that I actually have a t-shirt. I fucking have a t-shirt that actually says this. Screw the rules, I have money.
That's good advice.
Words to live by.
Rich people. If you can.
Okay.
Okay. So.
Sorry, I hijacked the podcast by actually talking about things that interest me. Sorry.
Don't let Jade stop you.
Running away from my Star Wars shit.
No, no, no.
Well, no, because you need to see the pictures on this next one. The next question is sexiest Star Wars alien, which we agreed before the podcast is the Hutts.
It's the Hutts? I thought it was, like, there was no debate that it was the, what, Twi'leks?
Well, yeah, I mean, the Twi'leks are usually the
slaves.
Like, most popular. I don't know about in-universe, but yeah. Yeah, they're definitely slaves, I think, like, in-universe. Unless you go.
Everybody wants to fuck them.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. Except in Shadows of the Empire, they say that the Fallen are the most beautiful, but they're. I don't know, I find them kind of ugly, actually. They're, like, reptilian-ish green humanoids. I mean, the Twi'leks are the most popular, I guess. But the Hutts know what's up.
Okay.
Oh, look at that tongue. Just look at that tongue.
Yeah, and power is sexy, and the Hutts are always in control of everything.
Exactly, money and power.
Yeah. So, I officially don't want to see these pictures.
Well, you have to. First, yeah, you've got... I should have looked up this guy's species. I haven't. I'm bad. But the character's name is Ponda Baba, and he has a butt for a mouth.
Yeah.
You might recognize him. He showed up in Rogue One.
Yep.
Butt mouth. Yep, he's got a butt for a mouth, and then there's another species called the Tals, T-A-L-Z.
Aren't those, from the angle, it looks like those are balls.
Hmm?
But it's definitely a butt.
I mean,
it could be balls.
It pretty much looks like a butt. I mean, the Tals is usually known as the one that has a penis for a face, because he's got a little thing coming out of his face. I just uploaded that one. Okay. So, penis face and butt face. They're so sexy.
It just looks like a trumpet.
Mm.
I guess you need, I don't know, my imagination isn't that great, it seems.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm recycling old jokes right now.
Oh, that's fine.
These aren't my jokes. yeah. So I think, let me see, I wrote a list of species that I was going
of course
to
you
mention.
Did.
Yeah. Because I was excited. We're finally talking about the one thing that I know stuff about. I've wasted my entire life learning this stuff. And now I don't know where my notes went.
Now I kind of feel bad that we talked about other shit.
Yeah. I just sit here silently and listen and I'm happy to have friends, but this is what I know stuff about. I don't know, whatever. We're doing it live. okay, next question.
Humans count too, right? Because everyone's just an alien somewhere.
Yeah, humans. Most of them come from Corellia, as far as I know, unless they change that in the new canon.
I mean, most humans are ugly, but there are some good ones.
Yeah, I think there's multiple planets that the Fallen come from.
I'm ugly.
You're not. You're floofy.
Mm. Is that a picture? Okay, the loading. It's a bitmap. It's a really old picture.
Had to drag and drop it from Yahoo image search, and it's not working.
Oh, God. 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 Oh, God.
Should I open
it? Oh, God.
What?
Oh God, oh God, oh God, why are you doing this to me?
Okay, let's see what this is.
I'm gonna need a minute here.
To finish masturbating.
Come on, you computer, open it up. Even though this is probably all not gonna be in the recording anyway, because we're just staring at pictures.
I mean, I can leave it in and we post the pictures, no problem.
Oh, nice. I've seen other stuff by that artist. That artist has been drawing Star Wars porn for at least 10 years, and it's all got really creepy. I mean, he puts a lot of effort into it, but it's always got this really creepy, surreal feeling to the expressions.
There's Star Wars porn, and then there's that.
Whatever the fuck that was.
I'll have to show you the comic where Leia gets fucked by the Sarlacc.
The Sarlacc? Well, actually, isn't the Sarlacc a hole? in the ground?
Yeah, and it's got tentacles. But actually, no, because that one, it's like, at first they like throw her in the Rancor pit, and I think she gets fucked by like two Rancors at once, both in the same hole. And then the Sarlacc comes in later. I've read some weird stuff.
Yeah, this is the conclusion we can draw from this.
No one is surprised by this. Okay, so let me bring up the question list again. Mm-hmm. Favorite Star Trek movie?
Never seen one.
I think for mine it would be The Voyage Home, the one with the whales, because that one's fun. I don't personally like Wrath of Khan that much. I find it kind of boring. I mean, I get that it's a classic, but I don't know. I don't see why it's the best sci-fi movie ever, personally. I also have a soft spot for Generations. I know Kirk's death was kind of bullshit, but I really like the idea of the Nexus, probably because I have depression. Just the idea that that there's like a place in space that you could go where it's just happy, like it makes your mind happy all the time. It just creates images of things, so you're always happy and you can just live there forever. That idea really appeals to me. And the idea that Picard would have to willingly give that up in order to save lives is pretty touching, I thought.
Mm.
I don't know. The internet hates that movie, and I loved it. So, what do I know? Yeah, Sean must have seen some Star Trek.
Yeah, I have an answer now, but I want to hear Sean.
Oh.
I've seen all of them. I'm trying to remember which one it was that I'm thinking of. It had Christopher Lloyd as a Shakespeare quoting Klingon.
That's the sixth one. Undiscovered Country, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, because he was, like, toward the end of the movie, he's just, like, spinning around in his chair, gleefully shouting about the dogs of war.
Yeah.
You haven't heard Shakespeare if you haven't read it in the original Klingon.
Absolutely. My problem is I haven't seen them in a very long time, so I'm not really particularly sure what I would say is my favorite. I mean, honestly, Wrath of Khan does stand out. And it's really the reason people, Star Trek fans, love Wrath of Khan so much is that it single-handedly saved Star Trek. Star Trek Motion Picture was a jumbled mess, and it was cobbled together from the bits and pieces of a canceled new Star Trek series, and its plot was just, not only was it meandering and lame, but it had already been done in that entire story had already been done in a Star Trek episode, and it really was underwhelming for fans, underwhelming at the box office, and somehow they were able to convince the studios to give them the opportunity to make one more Star Trek movie, and if that didn't do well,
it was because of Star Wars that they thought sci-fi would be still popular.
Yeah, and the thing is, Star Trek Motion Picture just underperformed in every way possible. And then Wrath of Khan comes out and was a huge hit and was a legitimately good movie on its own. And that actually is what gave us the momentum to be the fact that we're still talking about a new Star Trek series, debuting this year. And, we have a new series of Star Trek movies, which has been happening. And none of that would have happened if Wrath of Khan hadn't been so good. So it's probably the most important Star Trek movie by far.
Mm.
But I'm going to sound like I'm being lame, but I'm going to kind of agree with Jade and say The Voyage Home, because it was the concept of
Voyage Home is the one that non-fans love because it's like a fun comedy sci-fi.
Exactly. The concept of taking Star Trek and making it into a comedy, like a fish out of water comedy set in the 1980s, San Francisco, or wherever the frick it was, that was a really big risk they took, and it paid off really well. There are some really iconic scenes, like, what was it? Colorful euphemisms?
Colorful metaphors?
Colorful metaphors, that was it, yeah. Double dumbass on you! Yeah, double dumbass on you. Which is great, because they didn't know what swearing was, because apparently you didn't swear in the future. and the bit where the Chekhov.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember the lyrics to that guy's beatbox thing. It was like a parody version of a punk song.
Yeah, and like Spock just casually reaches over, does the Vulcan nerve pinch on the guy, and everyone in the bus cheers.
Yeah, let's see, it was something like, "I hate you, and I berate you."
Yeah,
just anger and for no reason.
Yeah, and the great, because it was during the Cold War, the great scene with Chekhov going, "Where do you keep the nuclear vessels?"
Yeah, and that scene was actually like filmed with not extras. It was just like filmed on the street, and they got the people to sign waivers after, because they were just standing there asking random people about nuclear vessels, and there was like that one woman who wanders by, and he was asking where it was in Alameda, and she says, "Oh, it's across the river in Alameda." He's like, "Yeah, where's Alameda?" She wasn't an actress. She was just a pedestrian on the street who heard the strange person asking about Alameda and tried to give him directions.
And one of my favorite scenes in that movie is Scotty trying to use a computer.
When he talks into the mouse.
talks into the mouse. Hello!
Yeah, and then after he gives the guy the formula, and Bones is like, "Oh, isn't this going to mess up the future?" He's like, "Well, how do we know he didn't invent the thing?"
Yeah. Okay, a bit of a bootstrap paradox there, but you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was just a legitimately fun movie. It did have an environmentalist message to an extent, but it never like beat you over the head with it.
Yeah.
You know? And it was just, we said, a fun, funny, really enjoyable take on these characters and putting them in a situation where, you know, it can be played lightly for laughs, but there's still a seriousness to what's going on.
Mm.
Yeah, I'd say that it probably is my favorite, with Khan being second favorite, and all of that really third favorite would have to be the first J.J. Abrams movie.
Yeah. I like that one too, yeah.
I liked that in Into Darkness too. I liked them both, but the first one, it was just, I felt just a really just well-made movie.
Yeah, the first one was a tighter story, and I appreciate the way they do a reboot that isn't like a retcon. They establish that it's a new universe.
Yeah, so it's a completely different dimension, basically. If you're on the alternate universe theory, yeah, it's an alternate universe.
Yeah.
Everything that happened in the original Star Trek universe still happened.
Yeah, and as far, you know, like, I still keep expecting they'll do like another series where they bring Picard back, and it's just Spock vanished out of the universe when that disaster on Vulcan happened. And that's when he got sucked back in time to the new timeline.
And if I remember right, didn't they say the new series is coming out is going to be in the classic timeline?
I'm not sure about that. I think
I heard that.
Because I had heard it was going to be between original series and Next Generation, and I got excited, but then I heard it's actually before original series, so it's like between Enterprise and original series. I don't know.
I don't know.
I think they did say Kelvin timeline, so I think it is with the movies. Yeah. But back to the sexy aliens, I finally found my list, and there's a few others I forgot. Here's my real answer. The Chiss, just Thrawn species. I think he's pretty nice looking.
Looks like a Nazi.
Looks like a blue Nazi. They're the worst kind.
I don't know. I mean, you'd have to read Thrawn. He's pretty charming. He's like the Sherlock Holmes of villains.
Nice. Wouldn't that make him Moriarty?
I think there's another character who's sort of his Moriarty. There's this guy Nuso Ezva, who comes up in a lot of stories just about Thrawn, where he's like his nemesis. And then there's Captain Playon, or Playon, I forgot how it's pronounced, but he's like the Watson, who's like always there asking Thrawn questions, and then Thrawn explains all the deductive reasoning. Because Thrawn's whole deal is he can look at people's art and figure out how their mind works from it. So he like figures out people's battle strategies by looking at, like, he looks at like a vase that Admiral Ackbar made once and figures out his whole battle strategy from it.
Weird.
Yeah. Here's the Quarren. They have tentacles.
Cthulhuoid.
Kind of torn on that.
There's tentacle faces. And I got one more I wanted to look up. Let's find a good picture of this fucker. Familiar to anyone who's played Knights of the Old Republic all the way to the end? The damn sexy Rakatans.
I've played Knights of the Old Republic to the very end, but I don't recognize this guy.
Yeah, I don't remember them either.
Okay, they're on the last planet. They're the like in an
enclave. They're made of ricotta cheese, that we said?
Rakatan.
Rakatan.
Exactly.
Made of cheese.
Okay, enough dumb Star Wars.
They're the most delicious alien.
There was a comedy group, German comedy group, who in their weekly comedy show, they always had a skit where they parodied Star Trek, and they made a movie out of that.
Wow.
And that is my favorite Star Trek movie, if you want to take a look at it. It's kind of offensive.
I'll have to watch it after we're done recording.
Is it in German?
Yeah, of course. No, this is the official song of the movie. I think it's mostly in English. So
it's like Spaceballs, but for Star Trek?
No, it's way worse. It's not a good movie, but they're kind of famous for their Star Trek parody stuff. It's very unique, I'd say. You're going to see. If I leave this in, I'm going to link this in the video description.
Okay, so favorite Star Wars robot. Yeah, most of mine are the Knights of the Old Republic ones. I think because you get to spend time with them in the game, it feels like more of a personal connection. So I really like HK-47.
Me too, actually.
That was my answer.
Yeah, the one who wants to kill meatbags. He's fun. Yeah. And like T3-M4 kind of feels like my dog after having cared for him for two games. I also kind of like Goto from Knights of the Republic 2. He's interesting in that he's like a robot who pretends to be a front for a human when really he's just a robot. He's like an evil mastermind. Also, C-3PO was the first Star Wars action figure I ever got, so I have a special fondness for him too. And that was before I'd even seen the movie. I just saw a C-3PO action figure and thought it was shiny, and I wanted it.
I think I had one too. I don't know why. No, I haven't seen Star Wars till I was 20, but I'm pretty sure I had the toys as a kid. I don't know where they came from.
Yeah, because Star Wars is everywhere in the culture.
Did you have a dog?
No.
Oh, because sometimes dogs can eat little action figures, and a dog might have gotten loose, eaten a Star Wars action figure, and then pooped it in your yard, and you found it that way.
I didn't have a yard either, so your theory falls flat.
What, did you grow up in prison?
Those, files are still sealed.
Also, gonk droids are fun. They're like walking trash cans. Although, they're not really trash cans, they're power batteries, but it looks like a trash can that you would see in a store, and it's just got feet, and it walks around and it goes, gonk, gonk. There's I think, one in Jabba's palace in Return of the Jedi. There's at least one there. I know there's one in the torture chamber. It's the one that's getting its feet burned. So, next question. That one word funk where Austin talked about all the Star Trek weird and wrong Star Trek opinions, what do you think that he was right about the movies? I don't even remember his opinions.
Me neither. Were they good?
Probably. Because it's Austin. He's the best.
I heard that one recently, but all I remember is...
Was it that he liked Star Trek 3?
I think The Final Frontier was a good idea, bad execution. Yeah, no, I don't remember.
Yeah, I think he said he liked 3, and that's fine. I mean, 3's entertaining.
I like 3.
What's that one called?
Search for Spock.
It's the one, yeah, the one where they go to the planet and Spock's body is like growing back into a full-size Spock.
No, he hated that one.
Oh, he did?
They retconned something in that like Spock's death or something?
Yeah. Yeah, Spock dies in the second
movie. Yeah, no, he absolutely hated that
one. Yeah, because that's one that a lot of people in the fandom hate, so that wouldn't be a weird and wrong opinion. So I don't know.
I think the weird and wrong part was just Leon disagreeing with everything, so like a nerd.
And as we all know, Leon is always right.
Right. It's canon.
Okay, so now we have a Rogue One question. How lame was the Rogue One ship compared to the other ship they used earlier in the movie? So I guess if you don't remember, I think he's saying the Rogue One ship is that one that was like kind of squarish and it had the four wings that stick straight up, and mm-hmm. comparing it to the one that had the one that is called a U-wing. It has like two wings that stick forward, but they can fold out to the sides like a plane. Yeah, I...
Who cares?
I agree that the one at the end of the movie looked kind of crappy, but the thing with Star Wars ship design is that they have this thing called a repulsor lift that is basically anti-gravity. So you can strap that onto any piece of crap you want, and it'll fly. You could just get like a box and stick a repulsor lift on it, and it'll fly. So they can make the ships look like whatever they want. They don't need to be aerodynamic.
Yeah, and also, the ship they were, I'm assuming we're talking about the one that they take to the planet at the end, it was meant to sneak in as a freighter.
Yeah, yeah, because it was a stolen Imperial ship.
Yeah, it was not a battleship. It was a friggin' freighter, and like that was how they got in, was because it wasn't anything special. It looked like a very generic freighter that the fucking Empire would just be like, yep, checks out. Or, you know, I mean...
Yeah, so it wasn't supposed to look... It was supposed to look lame. Okay, so next question. Favorite planet name in Star Wars? I actually have a link to the Wikipedia, which is thankfully a lot shorter than my Atlas.
I have an answer.
Oh, you do?
Don't need any... Tatooine.
Yeah, I like Tatooine, sounds too. Cool. It's a fun name, but there's a lot of other names. Like, I was looking at my Atlas, and that one has hundreds and hundreds of names. But most of them only appear once in, like, one book ever.
Jade, you have a problem.
I know. I don't have friends. I just have Star Wars. It's a sad life.
No, it's not.
This whole episode is just a dedication to Jade's wasted youth.
It's okay.
There's one here called Felucia.
Yep.
I can only imagine is when they left that planet, they went, bye, Felucia.
Coruscant is also nice. Yeah, I forgot mm-hmm. that one.
Yeah, and Coruscant's especially nice because it comes out of the Heir to the Empire book. Timothy Zahn invented the planet, and George Lucas liked it so much that he put it in the movies. Hmm. I'm going to say mine is Korriban, because fuck you, Disney. It's named Korriban, not Moriband. Long story short, there's a planet of Sith Lords, which it appears in Knights of the Old Republic, and it's called Korriban in that game. It's called Korriban everywhere else. And really, it wasn't Disney's fault. It's George Lucas's fault. Season 6 of Clone Wars, they decided to go to that planet, but George decided he liked the name Moriband better than Korriban, so he had the planet renamed. And before Disney took over, they were going to work a fix in there to say that the Jedi called it Moriband, but everyone else called it Korriban. But then Disney took it over, and now it's just called Moriband. Because fuck everyone, that's what it is.
There's a planet called Mon Calamari.
Yep. That's where the Mon Calamari species comes from. That's Admiral Akbar, the fish-faced guy. He's a Mon
Calamari. Why?
In other sources, the planet is called Dak, D-A-C, but for some reason they still call it by the main species, Mon Calamari. Because the Mon Calamari are kind of racist against the Quarren, that tentacle-faced group. They also live on that planet, but nobody calls the planet Quarren. They call it Mon Calamari because they're like the dominant race on that planet. I talked about dumb Star Wars names before, didn't I, with Elon's?
Yeah, but that is unacceptable. That is just unforgivable.
Mm.
Mustafar? That's a name.
Yep, that is
there's
the volcano
people,
planet.
There's people out there who are called Mustafar.
There are? I didn't know that.
I knew, never known a Mustafar, but I did used to work with a Mustafa.
Yeah, I mean...
There's no R at the R. end.
This is not canon in my world.
Zanama Seacup's cool. It's a living planet. Mm. It can, like, travel through hyperspace on its own, because it is just, like, a planet that's alive.
Nice.
Yeah. Did you know Peter Quill's dad is going to be a planet in Guardians of the Galaxy 2?
Who?
Have you seen Guardians of the Galaxy 1?
No.
No.
Of course not.
Well, the main character's dad is a planet. We're going to find out how that works in a few months.
I mean, sure.
So that's amazing that, like, wow. The Yo Mama joke just literally, Yo Mama fucked a whole planet.
Yep, she did.
Your mom's pissy so big, it got a continent in there.
Okay, so
is that a tingle story?
That could be.
Pounded in the butt by my dad, who's actually an entire planet.
Oh God!
That was a tingle incest story. Tingle sass.
Tingle sass. That's what the episode is called now.
Tingle sass.
Of course.
For the one tingle joke.
Now this is making me want to like find my copy of Knights of the Old Republic and reinstall it, despite the fact I'd have no time to ever play video games, and I just bought like a ton of video games.
Yeah. I got Knights of the Old Republic on my tablet, but I haven't gotten past Dantooine because I just haven't had time to go back to it. It's a good game, but it's a long game. Like every RPG, really.
Yeah, they are all just like forever games. Mm-hmm. I never beat Knights of the Old Republic 2, though.
Yeah.
Like, I always got like 2/3 of the way through, and then it was interest.
It's one of the very few games that I finished.
They had to rush the game for release, so the end of the game isn't really finished.
Yeah.
But there's a version.
Yeah. If you get the PC version, you can see the whole thing. I still haven't. But. Okay. Favorite sci-fi movie that is not a Star Wars movie? And, like, I was looking through mine. I'm not sure. Maybe Alien? Like, the first one? That one was really good. I'm not sure.
I really don't like sci-fi in general. I mean, I wouldn't go out of my way to watch sci-fi movie, but if I had to name one, I guess it would be Serenity.
Mm.
Because that's one that I actually watched multiple times. You know that one, I guess.
Yeah, I saw that one. I haven't seen Firefly, but I did see Serenity.
No, me neither. I have just seen Serenity as, I guess, likable characters and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, or possibly the Riddick movies. Vin Diesel is great.
I've always been way more on the fantasy end rather than sci-fi.
Yeah, because I prefer sci-fi over fantasy usually, but most of my sci-fi is either Star Wars or video games, like the earlier Halo games. I like those. Perfect Dark is like a near future sci-fi, but like, I was just looking over my movie collection. I don't have that many sci-fi, really, which is surprising.
I do enjoy some sci-fi. I mean, I'm a huge Doctor Who fan, and Doctor Who is ostensibly sci-fi, but also it's not movies.
Could say Star Trek is a movie because it's not Star Wars.
Yeah, but I don't know if I really feel all that hyper passionate about any sci-fi movie I've seen. I feel like I'm copping out, but it's just, I don't really know if I have an answer for it.
Mm. Okay, so next question. I don't know what this is about. Fuck Mount Lafayette in space? Who fucks Mount Lafayette? I don't know.
Not me.
to.
It's a mountain.
Yeah, but what... Because he's asking...
According to Google.
He asks all sci-fi Star Wars-ish questions except for Mount Lafayette in space being fucked. I don't get it.
Well, how do you know that Lafayette is being fucked? Maybe someone being pounded in the ass by Mount Lafayette.
So it's a living
mountain? It's apparently Appalachian... I don't know how to pronounce that.
Appalachian.
Appalachian.
Yep.
Mountain Club. So this is somewhere in that corner.
Bright's from Massachusetts. The Appalachian goes through Massachusetts. So they start in Maine and they end in like Tennessee, I think.
Okay, so
Bright, if you want to go fuck Mount Lafayette in space, go for it. I approve.
I will watch. We support your decision.
Wait. No. Hold on. No. Wait a minute. Are we actually doing this? We are encouraging to engage in underage sex?
With a mountain.
No.
No, not us, the mountain.
When the mountain could go to jail.
Okay. Mountains don't obey people laws.
Well, they should. Listen, Bright, wait until you turn 18 before having sex with any mountains, okay? Listen, they're just trying to use you. Really.
Mountains are older than all of humanity. They're like gods to us. They can do whatever they want.
It's pretty hard to arrest a mountain because the handcuffs don't fit.
But you can always say no and run away and the mountain can't chase you. All I'm saying, Bright, just please, have respect for your body and respect for yourself. Don't fuck any mountains until you're 18.
Alright, I guess.
Okay, so his last question in this set is, what does killing off Han Solo do? What happened to him in the expanded universe stuff that we're not going to see?
I can answer the first question really easy.
Yep.
It really fucking made Harrison Ford happy.
Yeah.
He wanted Han Solo dead since the first movie. Okay?
Yeah, he wasn't even supposed to be Han Solo. He was just the guy who they hired to read the lines to other people, and they liked him so much that they made him play Han Solo.
Yeah, and he hated the role, has hated playing Han Solo so bad his entire life. It's the one role he wishes he never did. And he wanted them to kill off Han Solo in Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah, which is why they froze him, because they weren't sure if they were going to get him back for a third movie.
Yeah, they finally talked him into it. And then the fact that they talked him into being in Force Awakens, I'm pretty sure part of the contract negotiation was, okay, but he's going to die on screen in a very non-ambiguous way, so you can't ever bring him back.
It was, actually.
Yes. So
it really was.
It made Harrison Ford happy. He finally got to friggin' bust that killing Han Solo nut he'd been working up for the last 30 years. So, yeah.
Yeah, and 40 years. Story-wise, what it does is it shows the conflict that Kylo Ren was going through between, like, his old life and his new life, and shows him making a decision that he's going to keep pursuing his dark path by killing off his father. And it's also a parallel to Obi-Wan's death and Qui-Gon's death, because really, the trilogies all mirror each other in a lot of ways. So if Force Awakens felt like a ripoff of A New Hope, Phantom Menace is kind of a ripoff of A New Hope, too. It just didn't know how to focus its plot correctly. But it's pretty much the same story. You've got an orphan on a desert planet who is pulled into this adventure, and then the mentor figure dies in conflict with the villain at the end, which was Qui-Gon, Obi-Wan, Han Solo. They all get killed by the Sith character in the, like, toward the end of the movie. So it's all just parallels, and they partly did it for the shock value. It's like, oh no, Han Solo's dead. Make some nerds cry. Yeah. As for what happened to him in the expanded universe, what happened, he got married to Leia. They had twins, Jason and Jaina. They had a third child, Anakin Solo. They continued to raise them as the New Republic. The Rebellion became the New Republic. They were still at war with the remnants of the Empire until, like, 20 years after Return of the Jedi. They finally called a truce. Immediately after which, the galaxy was invaded by the Yuuzhan Vong, who are like these aliens that come from outside the galaxy, and they hate mechanical technology. They have biotechnology. They have, like, snakes that turn into swords, and they have, like, their ships are living organisms that they live inside of. So when they came to the galaxy, in the first book of that series, they attack a planet with this creature that can, like, increase gravity, and it makes it so that the planet's moon is getting pulled toward the planet. And Han, Chewie, and their son, and Han's son Anakin, were all on that planet. And in order to get Anakin out on time, Chewie ends up having to stay behind. So Chewbacca dies when a moon falls on his head, destroys the planet. Han Solo, after that, is, like, so brokenhearted that he ends up leaving his family to wander the galaxy for a while. And in the time that he's gone, Anakin ends up dying in battle. Eventually he comes back. And then Jason ends up winning that war, but in the process kind of tipping toward the dark side to the point that he decides to make himself the new emperor of the galaxy in order to create a more secure galaxy, but he's still being a dictator, so he's still being evil. So his sister Jaina ends up training with Boba Fett to learn how to kill Jedi, and she kills her brother Jason. The whole thing going on with Kylo Ren is kind of similar to Jason Solo's turn to the dark side in the books, although they took out him having siblings, apparently, as far as we know at this point. Yeah, things don't really turn out that well for the Solo family, I guess. I mean, although eventually down the line, Jaina's descendants end up becoming like the ruling class of the galaxy. Yeah, there were more Han Solo stories past this time in the old universe. They decided instead, Chewbacca gets to live, Han Solo gets to die. And that's the new universe that the movies are all going to keep going with, so we'll see where it goes, I guess. Like it or not, that's what the mouse says it is, so that's what it is.
Doesn't have to be a bad thing.
Mm. Okay, let's see what... Oh, the next batch of questions is from Brightmarsh again.
Really?
Yeah. Okay, so he's asking about Rogue One this time. What did they leave out? What should they have left out?
From what?
From Rogue One. I don't know what they left out.
Is there source material?
Yeah, we haven't seen the deleted scenes. The source material was all flushed down the toilet by Disney, so since this isn't a direct adaptation of Dark Forces, which is the closest story to this, because Dark Forces is a video game about rebels stealing the Death Star plans. This isn't adapting that, so it's an original story. So I don't know what they left out, but what scenes should they have left out? That's kind of an interesting question. Like, what parts of the movie do you think they should have just thrown out?
I really can't think of anything that was really just superfluous.
I don't know, I think the tentacle monster, as much as I like tentacle monsters, the tentacle monster came out of nowhere and went nowhere.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say, yeah. Didn't serve a purpose, because didn't leave, like, a...
It just made his mind a little scrambly for a while, and they could have just done that by plugging him into a computer, but they wanted to do a creature, so they did a creature.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like, it seemed that they were implying when it was happening that it was, like, going to just, like, fry his brain completely, like, permanently, and then he's in the cell, and he's all, like, goofy, and he's like, oh my god, it's, like, lobotomized him. And then by the end of the, by, like, 10, 15 minutes later, almost, he's fine.
Yeah.
Like, nothing happened.
Yeah, it seemed like he lost some memories, and then they all just came back, and yeah, because it seemed more horrific when it first happened, that his mind is getting destroyed, and then...
He's like, I'm the pilot. I'm the pilot. I'm the pilot. You're like, oh my god, he's like, horribly brain damaged, and like, his entire life is ruined, and then he's like, oh, by the way, I remember everything, and I know how to, you know, do everything I ever know how to do before, and I'm perfectly fine.
Yeah, I remember all, like, the access codes to the Imperial base now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that just...
That's the one thing.
Yeah, like that, and like sort of everything with Saw Gerrera, it seemed like that character was being set up to be important, but then he just stands there and dies, so...
But can't you say that about every character in that
movie? Yeah, what they should have left out is left out the entire movie and do a better movie.
The one thing they should have put in was more blatant romance between gay blind monk and his bear husband.
Yeah.
Because I want to like learn how they got together and what they do for Thanksgiving and which one buys the more extravagant gifts on their anniversary. You know, I want to know that shit.
I don't know if they can afford any of that because it doesn't seem like they have money, but just seeing them be gay together would be nice.
Exactly, because there's such a fucking homoerotic subtext between them. These are obviously not just bros being bros. There is something much deeper going on. And I would go into bed like almost like elbow deep is how far we're going with that. I mean,
yeah,
we needed more gay monk in his friggin' minigun wielding bear lover. And it's just, I'm really sad that that wasn't more of a point.
Mm. It's because he reminds us so much of our favorite gay monk.
Perhaps. That's my absolute favorite part of the movie, though, with when they were going to see the guy and they're putting bags over everyone's head so they can't know where to get
Are you
it.
kidding me? I'm
Are you
blind.
kidding me? I'm blind. I love that. I don't really like jokes in Star Wars movies much. I love that joke.
Yeah, I thought the joke seemed out of character, but it is a good joke.
Yeah, because the way
It
he
was
was
not out of character. He was a goof.
the way he was saying it, though, it almost was like wasn't like he was telling a joke. He was literally just literally like just confused about why the fuck are you bothering to put this over my head? I can't see anyway. And it came across as a joke, but also didn't come across as him trying to tell a joke. Unlike the Vader joke, which was
Yeah, that was like a punchline to the end of his speech.
Yeah, they could have left that line out. And I think they could have left the entire scene out because Vader making small talk is bad.
Yeah, and like
Vader traditionally doesn't make small talk. One of the reasons he's so badass in the movies is number one, James Earl Jones, and number two, the fact that he doesn't talk a lot, and when he does, it's important shit.
Could you remind me of the joke? Because I don't remember him making a joke
It's when he's
that.
choking Krennic and he says, like, don't choke on your aspirations or
Yeah, something
your
like that, yeah.
ambitions or.
Yeah, don't choke on your ambitions. And like, it's
And then
so
he
out of
turns and
character.
he's making the gestures like, yeah, I'm choking you while I'm saying this.
I wouldn't interpret that as a joke, so
Yeah, it's like a serious
so
joke.
I was would say that's supposed to sound menacing, so my mind didn't jump to haha joke
Yeah, I think
that, so that's why I didn't remember it.
because it's a pun, we all took it as a joke.
And really, that whole scene where with Darth Vader just making small talk, it just felt so out of character for the character who literally a day later is going to be the man of very few words.
Yeah, and also a day later, he's not using his lightsaber to kill people anymore. So even though that killing scene was really cool, he's like cutting
Yeah.
people down with his lightsaber. When he gets to the hallway in A New Hope at the start, you never see the lightsaber. So he doesn't take out the lightsaber until his fight with Obi-Wan toward the end of the movie. So, because
Maybe it's he needs to recharge it.
he needed new batteries. But then even like that whole Vader chatting with Krennic scene, Krennic wasn't a very strong villain. Because like anytime he shows up alongside another villain, the other villain is just pointing out what a little bitch he is.
Yeah, they're very dismissive of him.
Like when he's with Vader, when he's with Tarkin on the base, and Tarkin is like just telling him, "Nope, I'm taking over your station now," and he starts whining about it. But he's supposed to be our main villain. He's like the guy with the fancy uniform and the cape, and he wasn't very threatening. I guess he seemed realistic in the sense that he's just like a petty man working for an evil government, but he wasn't that interesting as a villain.
Though, to be fair to the movie, this is the first and only Star Wars movie where the Empire as a whole seemed super formidable because, in that final space battle, which was pretty cool, at first the Rebels are doing really good because they have the element of surprise. But once the Empire starts to regroup, they kick some Rebel ass in outer space. And you really got the feeling that, wow, the Empire really is the clear favorite. The Rebels really are fucking underdogs who have really almost no chance of winning. Because in the original trilogy, yeah, okay, the Empire, we knew the Empire was big and the Rebels were scrappy Rebels. But you never saw a real scene where it looked like the Empire was just going to bitch slap the entire
Well,
Rebel
I
fleet.
mean, kind of
And
at the
it
start of Empire Strikes Back, where they smash their base.
Yeah, but I mean, the sense I got watching that final scene in Rogue One was that it's pretty dire straits, hopeless for the Rebel Alliance, that they are just outgunned and outmatched in every way, and it's a desperate situation. That kind of desperation, and even in the beginning of the movie you're talking about, I never got the feeling that it was a desperate situation where the entire Rebel Alliance could be wiped out in one battle. And I like that they gave us that. Admittedly, they were trying to make it grittier, darker, whatever, but I like that feeling of, wow, the Rebels are probably going to lose this shit. Yeah, that's what the feeling I got from it. I kind of like that because it really gave a little bit more of a feeling of what is actually going on in this war. That's just my opinion.
Okay, so then Brightmarsh asks, do you think there was any foreshadowing in Rogue One for what will happen in Episode 8? I've read theories that Darth Vader's castle might be Snoke's headquarters, which would probably be Episode 8 when they introduce that. That's the only thing I can see, really. Because the rest of the movie, everybody, they steal the plans that we knew they would steal, and then they all die.
Yeah, so it's like really that entire movie, because you knew the mission would succeed, because if it doesn't succeed, there's no Star Wars. So it's really just introducing you to a bunch of characters, some of them are really cool, and now we're going to tell you how they died. The end.
Yeah.
Because there's never any doubt that they're going to get the plans. If they weren't going to get the plans, then, you know,
yeah.
Star Wars Episode 4 wouldn't have happened.
Yeah, and since they're all dead, we won't get old versions of any of them showing up in Episode 8.
Mm-hmm.
And they nuked the Temple of the Wills, so that's not going to show up.
Yeah,
Actually, yeah, because the main planets that they showed were Jeddah and Scarif, and both of them got hit by the Death Star, so those planets are toast.
Well, they got hit by the Death Star in its lowest setting.
Yeah, but it's still enough to, like, wipe the surface of the planet, or at least that section of the planet. So even if the planet comes back, there's nothing to see there. It's all dead.
Aww.
Yeah.
Because they were ripping off Halo Reach again, pretty much. Because Halo Reach ends with the Covenant glassing that planet, where in glassing, it's like they bombard it with lasers until the surface is just fried and turned to glass. Because Austin, I agree with a lot of what Austin's complaints about Rogue One.
I still haven't listened to that, so I don't really know.
Mm.
But if his complaints are anything like Jade's complaints, then I guess it basically is almost the same thing as with Magical Beasts and Where to Molest Them. In that
they molest you.
I have a lot of the same, like the things that Jade doesn't like about it, those are things I felt were problems too. It's just that they're less of a problem for me. Like, the things that bug Jade about the movie really are, for the most part, things that bug me about it. It's just they bug Jade a lot more than they bug me.
Yeah, because I see so many movies that if I hate a movie, that doesn't mean I hate all movies. I've got other movies to like.
Hmm.
Yeah, but no, I'm saying, like, I agree with all your complaints. I just also, they don't bother me as much. It's just, you know, I can kind of like, okay, whatever.
Because you're old and lax and just let everything slide.
No, it's just because I go into movies with the intention of having a good time.
Okay, so next one is, what crackpot theories do you have about Star Wars?
Just gonna lean back here.
I mean, I think I'm so deep into the lore that it's hard to come up with theories because all I know are, like, the facts and former facts, so I don't know what would be a crackpot theory for me.
I don't have any.
You don't have?
No.
You probably don't care enough about Star Wars to think up theories about it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't have any weird theories. I've spent too much time actually studying the lore, so all I know is stuff. But even then, one of the weird things for Star Wars with me, I've tried like making my own Star Wars characters and writing my own Star Wars stories, and I find it really difficult to do. For some reason, it's like other things, you know, I don't have that problem, but for some reason with Star Wars, I don't know if it's just kind of restrictive.
So much of it.
There's like so much of it, but it's also kind of restrictive in some ways that there's like all these rules about things. So, and also, we'll get to it in a later question. The Star Wars universe is kind of a miserable place to live if you actually have to live there. Okay, so then Dash Shawn the Rage Monster. Subtitle Captain Bear asks, why was Darth so fucking shiny? Because he polished his armor, because he's at his house, and he was having a guest, and he wanted to look his best.
His common fucking courtesy.
Yeah. He just came out of his bath, you know, he got his upper torso pulled out and stuck into his suit, and he got it all washed and shined. He's got that guy in the bathrobe there to clean his suit for him.
If you know, have guests, you don't show up in your pajamas.
Why not?
Because that's rude.
Because he's rich enough to have servants who can clean his stuff for him.
But isn't he rich enough to be able to not care? Just show up in Darth Vader show up just in his boxers, smoking a cigar. Just going, fuck it.
Well, that wouldn't be scary enough.
No, but it would continue with the whole thing of people just showing no respect to the main villain. Darth Vader doesn't even bother getting dressed. You're like, fuck. Oh, he's here? Oh, I ain't gonna fucking put on pants for that motherfucker. Jesus Christ.
Wouldn't he have to wear the boxes over his...
Yes. Yes, he would. He would. He would have, like, heart pattern boxers over the Darth Vader legs.
Okay.
Yeah, because when they showed him in the tank, he only had, like, a chest and shoulder stumps and a head.
Yeah. That's how he works.
Yeah. He's got a robo dick.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so...
got 14 settings.
So Revan has some questions. He asks, is Jean-Luc Skywalker the boy who lived?
Isn't that guy dead?
I think he's mixing his stories here.
I know, but I'm just declaring that guy's dead.
Yeah.
So no.
We'll kill him.
We'll kill him.
No Jean-Luc Skywalker.
Gruesomely.
Yeah. He died when an evil wizard with a red lightsaber and, I don't know, some Star Trek.
Dick.
Yeah, some Star Trek thing. Some combination of those three killed him. Okay.
But good question. Yeah.
Favorite Jedi?
I don't know too many, but it's either Obi-Wan, but just, you know, Ewan McGregor, Obi-Wan exclusively, or I can't remember her fucking name, the lady from Knights of the Old Republic 2.
Bastila?
The blind one.
Oh, wait, Knights of the Old Republic, Kreia. Yeah.
Two. Kreia, right.
Yeah, Kreia's that would, great.
She's a badass.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I'd call her a Jedi. She would fit for the next question, though.
Wasn't she trained as a Jedi?
Yeah, no, yeah, she was a Jedi. She was Revan's teacher, and then
right.
She turned to the dark side and established her Sith Academy.
So that doesn't count, right?
Well, I guess...
I'm not clear on the rules.
I don't know, I guess she could count, because like, I have Revan as one on my list, and he was a Jedi who turned evil, who turned back to good, so...
You know, this fucking goody-two-shoes shit's not for me.
Yeah.
Not into that.
Yeah, none of mine are pure good characters. There's Revan, who's, like, even as a good guy, he was still a strategist. And then Mara Jade, of course. Mara Jade was, like, she served the Emperor, but she wasn't fully force-trained, and even working for the Emperor, she wasn't, like, super evil. She tried to do what she thought was best for the Empire and the citizens of the Empire. So she's more like a tough cop, I guess. Before the Empire collapsed, and then she was just like a freelance smuggler for a while. And Cade Skywalker, who's Luke's great-grandson. He's a drug addict. He kind of dabbles in the dark side. So he was kind of... He's like Han Solo's attitude with Luke Skywalker's legacy. Like, stuffed together.
Nice.
So he's, like, a dashing rogue guy, but he's also a Jedi. His backstory, which is in, like, the first issue of the Legacy comics, is also pretty dark, and it's pretty touching, actually, the way they go about it. He was at the Jedi Academy on Ossus when the Sith, because the Sith had reassembled into an army. They attack the planet, start killing everyone. He's escaping. His father gets killed in the battle. And then, like, his teacher also gets killed, and he's just gotten so sick of everyone dying that he taps into the dark side, uses that lightning ability to bring his teacher back to life. But having tapped into the dark side, he kind of freaks out about his own power, runs off, is presumed dead, but he's actually still alive. He's, like, slumming it as a bounty hunter for a while. And he takes death sticks to try to suppress visions, because Luke Skywalker is appearing to him as a force ghost, telling him he needs to live up to his family legacy and do his duty as a Jedi, and he's just taking these drugs to make the vision disappear. So, he was a pretty entertaining character.
Yeah. Sounds like it.
I honestly don't have one.
Mm.
I mean...
None from all those CGI people in the background of episode 2?
I slept through episode 2.
Mm. Or Kit Fisto getting killed like a punk by Palpatine when he just stands there and Palpatine pulls his lightsaber up and stabs him.
Mm.
Actually, Mace Windu is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. All I can think of when I think of, you know, Jedi isn't even an actual Jedi. It's just the fact that how fucked up it is that the Jedi mind trick is a light side power.
Mm. Yeah.
When it's literally the superpower of Kilgrave.
Yeah, that.
Like, Jessica Jones, he's the most evil fucking villain and one of the most evil villains in Marvel history, and his superpower is the Jedi mind trick.
Yeah, that.
How is that a good guy move? It's brain rape.
Yeah, pretty much. Although, actually, I just remembered another favorite Jedi, Skippy the Jedi droid. It's from a comic where, remember that red droid that blew up, and then they, at the start of New Hope, the Jawas had all those droids. They had R2 and 3PO lined up, and they try to pick out a red droid to be their R2 unit, and it just explodes, and then they go with R2 instead. There's a comic that says that, I mean, it was a joke comic. It wasn't intended to be canon, but it's still hilarious. And now that none of that's canon, I'm calling it canon. That red droid discovered it had Jedi powers. It was like attuned to the Force. And it saw a vision of the future that everything would end horribly if R2 didn't go with Luke Skywalker. So it used the Force to blow up its own perfectly good motivator, making everyone think it had a bad motivator. I think I actually have scans of that comic. I should upload it and share it with you sometime.
Yeah.
Because it's great. It's a comedy story. It's all tongue-in-cheek. There's a lot of jokes that you'd only get if you've, like, watched A New Hope so many times that you know all the lines, but because they parody some of the dialogue. Okay, so best antagonist in the expanded universe, Kreia, Darth Kreia would count for that, definitely.
Okay, cool.
She was super interesting. Like, I love her whole deal where she hates the Force because the Force has a will and the Force is like God controlling everyone's lives, and she hates that it's like crushing her independence. So it's like she's a Force user, but her end goal is she wants to kill God by just cutting everyone off from the Force, which is just mind-blowing.
Pretty badass, yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, she's definitely... I think she was on my list. Let's see, where's my list? Yep. Yeah, I got her on there. I like Nihilus from that game, too, the one who's all in armor. Because, you know, he doesn't even talk, he's just like a ghost. He's just... Like, instead of dying, he decided to just bind his soul to this suit of armor. And he keeps living on in his crazy ghost ship, just going around sucking the Force out of planets. Of course, and Thrawn, Johnny's favorite, and amazing character. Very excited that he's coming back to have more stories. I mentioned the Yuuzhan Vong before. They're pretty interesting with their whole culture. They're super violent, though. So, Sean, do you have to get going?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I have a lady person I have to pick up. All right, I'm just going to do an outro that we won't use, okay?
Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to use it.
Yeah?
Okay.
And I'm going to leave it here, so you just, you know.
All right, everybody, I have to run, but this has, in fact, been something similar to Funk Dunk, and I'm not sure if you squint, you might be able to even not tell that I wasn't here for the ending. Everybody have a good night, have a good week, and really, when it comes down to it, if at all possible, don't murder anyone. But if you do, I'll understand. Peace.
Tell us about it.
Write a story about it.
Write a battle rap about it.
Mm.
We need more rap battles in the shack.
Okay, so, yeah, so before I move on to the next question, I definitely have to say my favorite villain is Darth Bane, just because it's my favorite book of all books, Darth Bane, Path of Destruction. It's just a brilliant breakdown of
this. Isn't that the guy from Batman?
There is a Bane in Batman, yeah. Mm. This one's Darth Bane. He's bald, like Bane from Batman. But his story, he's a, works on a mining colony, because his dad is like an abusive drunk who has gotten him and his son just so embroiled in debt that they have to work there just slaving away in these mines. One day his dad's beating him and he just takes it, but then when he's laying there in his bed, he's just so angry, wishing his father would die, that he pretty much accidentally taps into the dark side, crushes his father's heart, and kills him. So after that, he's just, you know, still, he didn't even know it was him doing it. He just figured, well, the bastard's dead. But he inherited all of his debt, so he's just stuck on this planet, slaving away. He ends up getting in a fight with some Republic soldiers and having to flee the planet and join the Sith army, because this is Old Republic back when the Sith had an army. So it wasn't like entirely his fault that he ends up going dark. It was just the circumstances of his life kind of drove him to it. So he goes there, joins their army, becomes a soldier. He has like a talent for predicting things, and from that they figure out he's actually got force powers, so they end up sending him away to the Academy for Sith on Korriban. And then he trains, he gets into fights with those other students, he studies the philosophy, and there's even like one point in it where he figures out like giving into your emotions the way they do is self-destructive, and he almost turns away from the evil, but then ends up giving into it anyway, because I think it's just all he knows. And it's like, it's what he had to do to survive, is to just keep giving into it. And he's, like, by the end of the book, he figures out that the whole idea of the Sith, you know, their organization, it doesn't work as an army, because they have to be nice enough to each other. Like, they have to quell their ambitions enough to work together, which doesn't work if you have this, you know, like, if you can tap into the Force and if you can just keep building your ambition and keep getting stronger and stronger, then you shouldn't have anything holding that back. So he ends up, he tricks the leader of the Sith into wiping out his entire army with this ancient Force technique. And then he takes over and sets up the whole rule of two, one master, one apprentice, takes on this girl who he finds on the battlefield, who's like, she's, I don't know how old she was, like maybe 10 or 12. She's just this little girl who, she'd gotten like lost and befriended one of the creatures on the planet, but the creature ends up getting killed by some Republic soldiers who thought it was dangerous. So she freaks out and sort of accidentally, intentionally kills them with the Force. He finds her, takes her on as his apprentice, and then the sequel book and the book after that are about their training in the dark side and her eventual taking over, killing him, and becoming the new master.
Of course.
Yeah, he's a really interesting character, really sympathetic in his portrayal. I love that book. I read it again like a year ago, and I still love it just as much as the first time I read it.
Yeah, sounds pretty cool.
Yeah. Okay, so favorite spaceship. I mean, for me, it mostly goes back to the video games, because like in Knights of the Old Republic, the Ebon Hawk is your Millennium Falcon. So just having seen every room inside of that ship, learned it inside and out, I love the Ebon Hawk. It's not that it's the best design ship, it's just it feels like home after living in it for two games. I also like the Outrider a lot. That's the one from Shadows of the Empire. And like in the last, because I was a lonely child, I played Shadows of the Empire on N64. And in the last battle of that one, you get this ship called the Outrider that is, it's like the Millennium Falcon if it was built sideways. It's like a circle with the cockpit is like attached to the side of the ship.
Mm.
So that one, I just enjoyed doing barrel rolls in it. I think you hold the Z button and you can make the ship spin around. And that's something I hadn't been able to do in other games. So that's mostly why I like that.
Hey, I guess, I mean, I didn't have an answer before because I couldn't think of anything, but now that you say it, I mean, of course, then the Ebon Hawk, because
yeah. I
played that, and actually, I think, how long is the sequence where you just try to get the ship running? It was like at least 3 hours of playtime or something very beginning.
You had to like steal the ship and fight off all those people, and then the planet starts getting attacked, so right, it becomes your getaway ship.
You just spend so much time completely alone.
And then, like,
running around on that ship.
Yeah, you get on the ship, and then you have to, like, deal with that those creatures that get loose in the cargo bay, and...
Mm-hmm. Yes. Then, of course, yeah.
Yeah, and you've got, like, all the rooms, and all your friends are hanging out in the rooms, and...
Mm.
Go and talk to Candorus and hear his war stories out in the back engine room.
A few potted plants would be nice, but, you know.
Yeah, because I like those ships, and I like, in... Rogue Squadron on N64. One of the last ships you get is the V-Wing, and that one I like just because you can kind of cheat. Like, if you're using the unlimited ammo code, it has cluster missiles that automatically target enemies that they detect. And since it was pretty hard to figure out where the enemies are sometimes in that game, you just fly in, just spam cluster missiles, and kill everything. That's why I like the V-Wing. V-Wing Speeder, because there's like two or three different things calling themselves the V-Wing now. Okay, what color lightsaber would you have?
Pink with a black hilt.
Actually,
my favorite color combination.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I think you might be able to get pink in Force Unleashed, because there's like three shades of red. You can get this like light, middle, and dark red. Yeah, because otherwise...
But the black hilt is very important. It's a must.
Hmm. Yeah, I think I'd go for white, like white or silver. Those ones are pretty cool. I mean, those are the ones the Imperial Knights use in the Legacy comics. Ahsoka in the Rebels cartoon is now using them, although they've changed the meaning of the lightsaber. They've made it so instead. Like, the lightsaber she has was once a red lightsaber, but the new version of lightsabers, they're kind of like Harry Potter wands. They choose you to be...
Yeah.
Your master to be its master, and like if you're mean to your lightsaber, you make it bleed and turn red.
Mm.
In the old system, it was just a different crystal type, like a synthetically yeah. made crystal would make it turn red. In the new version, it's that they all start off with colors like blue or green or purple, but then if you're mean to them, they turn red. But if like she took someone else's red one, but she was nice to it, I guess. So it drained of that color and it just became white, which is to represent that she's neutral because she left the Jedi Order after the Jedi Order kind of fucked her over in Clone Wars cartoon. Because there was like one point she was accused of murder and they just turned her over to the government to face trial, even though the trial was being run by Tarkin and he's anti-Jedi. But it's like they knew that, but figured politically it was the right thing to do to just hand her over. So.
Mm.
After she was acquitted, she said, "No, fuck you guys," and she just walked out. So she's not really Jedi anymore, but she's not Sith either. She's just a gray Jedi, is what they usually call the in-between. Mm. So I think I'd go with white, and I'd want it to be like double-bladed, like the Darth Maul one, because I like staves, that kind of long weapon that you can hit with either end. Mm. I'd probably cut my own leg off, but...
Yeah.
It'd be fun until I got my leg off.
Definitely.
Okay.
Fun for 30 seconds.
Yeah. So, Brent asks, why did Jade brainfuck that guy in Rogue One?
Yeah.
Because he was hot. Wouldn't you want to brainfuck that?
That juicy brain?
Mm.
Now, I probably would have gone for the dick, so...
Mm.
Well, I don't know what that brain thing...
It cut away before you got to see exactly what the tentacles were touching.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It could be touching everywhere.
Maybe all over the place.
Maybe it was just touching the dick and it just made his mind go crazy so he couldn't talk about it.
The question is, why wouldn't she? Right? Wrong fucking question.
Yeah. Yeah, Brent, why wouldn't you?
Why wouldn't you, Brent? What's wrong with you?
Yeah. Okay, so Bright Marsh asks, what's with the seeming connection between Star Wars and Christmas? Is there a connection?
I mean, Christmas, you know, the three wise men, they followed a star.
Okay.
And maybe that star was one
the
of
Death
the,
Star?
Was the, maybe.
Yeah, I don't know, because in the holiday special, it's not even Christmas, it's Life Day.
I think it's just the star thing. The following the star thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only thing I can think of. Maybe that star was on its way to a war.
Mm.
if you don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Dark Kent has some questions that aren't Star Wars related. I'll get back to those.
Oh.
Let's see. Zen Psychosis, our bringer of class, asks, who's your favorite Star Wars character that's not Force sensitive? Probably Boba Fett. At least in his book version, he's pretty badass. I mean, and Leia's cool, although she's technically Force sensitive. She's just not trained in it.
I think she is, yeah. It's a hard question.
Did you like Han Solo?
No. Not particularly.
Chewbacca isn't Force sensitive.
Yeah, but I mean...
The droids aren't Force sensitive. This is mostly my day, I guess.
I mean, I like it. I like it well enough. I don't retain any information. It's not something I think about.
Yeah, that's like me with anime. I've seen it. It's fine. It's fun, but I don't remember most of it.
Yeah.
If you could live a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, where would you want to live and what would you be doing? Yeah, so this is the thing I was saying earlier. The Star Wars universe is kind of a sucky place to live because it's constantly at war. Especially in the books, if you like look at the timeline, there is a war or major conflict going on every year of pretty much every part of the timeline that's ever been covered. It's just everybody's dying all the time. There's always war.
Yeah, you'd be used to it. So,
well, you'd either be like a regular mechanic or some like boring job living off a desert planet as a moisture farmer, or you'd be like a Jedi or something, and you'd be going on adventures, but all your friends are dying horribly, and you're probably going to get tortured at least once.
I kind of like the aesthetic of desert planets, but I guess...
If you're okay with a boring life, there's lots of places for a boring life to happen.
I mean, I guess Kashyyyk.
Mm.
Because there's lots of floofs there.
Mm.
I mean, I don't think they like to be petted. Maybe some maybe.
Yeah, I mean, if you're nice and you're not trying to enslave them, then yeah, probably.
For those who are not in the know, that's the Wookiee planet. And it's also a jungle, and I think the weather is probably nice, and I mean, it's probably a little moist, but generally, probably, you know, for landscape-wise, one of the better choices, and yeah, just floofs, you know.
Yeah.
I guess.
Coruscant could be kind of nice, I guess. Like Upper Coruscant, not Lower Coruscant. Okay, so would you be willing to visit Star Wars Land at a Disney park when it's completed, perhaps in the cosplay of a decanonized expanded universe character as a form of protest? Which I assume is directed at me. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, because I can't.
Yeah.
Unless I spend lots of money.
I'd have to spend lots of money, too. I live in Maine, and the Disney parks are in Florida and California, so that's either all the way south in America or all the way west. So I'm not likely to, I've never been to Disneyland or Disney World. I don't think it's ever going to happen. I'm not that much of a park person anyway. I don't like the crowds. But if I were to go, I'm sure I'd probably get something out of it, and I might go as Revan because I have a full Revan costume. Otherwise, I mean, if I could get in shape and work up the courage, I'd rather go as Slave Leia, but I'm sure there's a lot of better looking Slave Leias there. So, plus Disney is so family friendly that they'd probably kick me out.
Fucking lousy with Slave Leias.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you ever seen any of the pictures of like at conventions where they get like 100 Slave Leias all together?
I mean, that's just lame, if you ask me.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, like one Slave Leia stands out, but when you have multiple, it just looks kind of boring.
Yeah. Think of something original. Just, you know.
Well, I mean, some of them have, like, translated the Slave Leia costume into, like, Disney princess forms. So there's, like, a blue one that is Slave Elsa, and there's a green one that's Slave Tinkerbell.
Of course, because we don't have any other problems.
Yeah. Yeah, cosplay culture is weird. Okay, drink of choice while sitting in a cantina listening to a lively jizz tune.
You want to say it or should I?
It's obviously blue milk.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Okay.
I don't know.
What, are you drinking jizz?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I mean, yeah, I was just going to go right with there. The Star Wars go-to of either Blue Milk or Death Sticks, because according to the Legacy comics, Death Sticks are like little, they kind of look like science vials of chemicals, so they're drinkable. And they, I guess, make you forget everything. Okay, Mirren asks, I would like to buy a Star Wars, thank you. How much Star Wars can I get for $10?
I can have all my Star Wars. That's probably what it's worth.
Yeah, for $10, you could get probably one of the small action figures, the ones that only bend at the arms and the legs and the head.
I really love how you're answering that question.
Yeah, of course I know this stuff. Yeah, because if you want to get the good figures that are 6 inches, those are going to cost you at least $15 to $20 on average. So for $10, you can get one of the crappy ones. But I mean, they're decent molds, usually, decent paint jobs. Terrible expressions. They're usually just really stiff looking. Okay, Bright Marsh asks, do you consume lesser Star Wars fans? How do you do it? Do they contain much nutritional value? No. It's actually the opposite. The lesser Star Wars fans are consuming everyone else because there's a lot more of them. Nerds like me are a dying breed. Well, I don't know about that, but in the minority. Everything Disney's done with their new approach is to appeal to the more casual Star Wars fan market. You know, they throw in little nods to the movies and get everyone super excited that, oh boy, Han Solo and the Millennium Falcon and Chewbacca and Princess Leia and Luke Skywalker and all these characters from my childhood are back, because the people they're trying to appeal to are the people who watched Star Wars as kids and haven't engaged with it ever since, which is why they just flushed all the books, you know. The fans who actually kept this thing alive all these years, like even like the prequels didn't just come out of nowhere. After Return of the Jedi, George Lucas had pretty much given up on Star Wars. He was just done with it. The franchise went dead for a few years, and then Bantam Spectra bought the rights to make a book, decided they were going to do a really good job and hire a professional sci-fi writer to do it. So that's where the book Heir to the Empire came from, and it was a smash hit that led to a series of more books, which then led George Lucas to decide, hey, I can actually make those prequels now. So he made the prequels, for better or for worse. All the while, more books, more video games, more comics, all this stuff just kept churning out. And there's some really, really good stories in there, if you know where to look. I can tell you where to look. But yeah, there's a lot of really good stories. Like, even like, most of the Dark Horse comics that I've read, Marvel used to do Star Wars comics, and most of them were crap. But when Dark Horse took over, most everything I've read of theirs is good. Even if it wasn't great, it was still entertaining enough. Like, I'm struggling to think of anything that was really bad in stuff that they made. There are some really bad books, but there's also some really, really good books. So there's a lot of good stuff there, but Disney wants to appeal to the widest possible demographic, which is people who've only seen the movies and probably don't even know that the books exist or ever existed.
When I was younger, I hadn't seen the movies. Like I said, I saw them 10 years ago. Was forever the first time I saw them.
Yeah.
But when I was younger, I was under the impression that those things, the Star Wars movies, were like movie adaptations of books.
Oh.
And it was really surprising to me to find out that the books came afterwards.
Yeah, I think the original novelization of the first movie might have come out shortly before, because it was like written at the same time, but it was written to be a tie into the movie. The movie was an original idea by George Lucas, sort of original. He had wanted to make a Buck Rogers movie, I think, but he couldn't get the rights, so he decided to make his own sci-fi story. So it's either Buck Rogers or Flash Gordon, one of those. So it was like inspired by that, but it has more spirituality, metaphysical, philosophical stuff to it. With like the Force and stuff. Yeah, so okay. So we've got Dark Kent, Routnark, MC Skunk has a few questions. Okay, so he asks, have any of you ever read Sun Ken Rock? Nope.
Sorry, no.
No, I don't I don't anime, I don't manga, I don't know this stuff. I'm catching up. What's your favorite homoerotic tension-filled shonen?
Let me look this up. I don't know what it's called. Wait.
Yeah, because I don't know enough to know what a shonen... What's a shonen and what's not a shonen?
Shonen is, boy stuff.
Okay, so, like, the action stories?
Yeah, right. Like, Naruto and,
Okay.
I don't know if this counts, because it's actually not... I think the question is more, like, non-canon. Like, just two...
Yeah, just seems
canonically
like
straight guys. Yeah. But you know that they're super into each other.
Yeah.
There's an anime called Cute High Earth Defense Club, which is, I'm going to show you this,
okay,
which is basically a parody of Magical Girl anime.
The inspiration for Magical Girl drop?
No. This is guys who transform into...
magical boys.
Yes.
With their little sailor uniforms.
It's so awesome. This thing is so awesome. It's very funny. It's just, they have a mascot. Mm-hmm. I think it's a wombat who talks. And it's just, you know, all those cliches packed into there. But also, it only has a season, I think. So it's not even a huge time investment. And I think it's really, really worth it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very, very apparent that, you know, this is supposed to be into each other. The anime plays with that.
Mm.
Like, the anime ships the characters.
Mm.
Although none of them ever state that they're gay.
Yeah, so I was thinking about mine. I've only seen a few episodes. I don't remember if it was really that homoerotic. I mean, maybe Fist of the North Star. I know it had, like, a lot of muscle dudes who were constantly shirtless, so there's probably something homoerotic going on there.
Never seen that.
Yeah, it's like a guy who can punch people and make their heads explode, I guess. Something, I don't know. It's like Mad Max meets Bruce Lee. Like, post-apocalypse, guy who looks like Bruce Lee is just beating people to death to try to save his wife from this villain who stole her.
Nice.
Okay, so Dark Hand's last question. I know that whatever happens on the House of Libra stays in the House of Libra, but what exactly happened in the House of Libra?
Someone read a book?
By the
name?
Yeah, I'm not sure. What's the House of Libra?
I don't know.
Okay.
But Libra means book in Latin, I think.
Yeah. And Libra is also one of the astrological signs, I think. Which I assume is... But I don't know much about Libras.
Yeah, I'm a Libra. A Libra. House of Libra.
Okay, then the House of Libra was full of awesome people.
Oh. This... Google doesn't help at all, you know?
Yeah, because, I mean, like, the Whatever Happens line is Las Vegas, and he's just applying it to this House of Libra, but I don't know what that is.
So I guess I'm sticking to my answer. Somebody just probably sat down, had a nice glass of tea, and read a book.
Hmm. Sounds like a nice place.
Mm-hmm. It's a pleasant evening.
Yep. So that's it for questions.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, I guess since we didn't do that many questions last week, we had twice as many, so it took us 3 hours to get through this.
I mean, it took us only 3 hours this time to get through the questions.
Yeah.
What I wanted to say, I didn't want to disrupt the whole flow, but I fucking loved Rogue One.
Oh.
I love that movie so much, really. And I think my theory on that is because I never watch movies.
Mm.
So when I do, you know, I haven't seen all of it a thousand times over. It's like when you eat pizza every day, it's just sort of like, yeah, pizza, whatever. But go a year without pizza, it's probably, or, you know, sex, whatever, if you don't like pizza.
I think that's why Sean liked it more, too, that Sean doesn't watch movies as often as I do. So it's still a special occasion to go see a movie.
Yeah, I wasn't, you know, I sat there like, geez, these nerds want to talk about this tomorrow. I better watch it.
Mm.
And I was really not expecting to like it at all because everyone said it was disappointing.
Mm.
And, you know, just the whole concept didn't seem too appealing to me. But I really, really, really freaking loved this movie. Mm. I couldn't even put my finger on what exactly. I mean, I like the action.
Is it like the characters?
Some of the characters were the two main characters were not effective at all.
No. No,
absolutely not.
The monk and his boyfriend were a lot more fun. And the robot.
Yeah. The robot. The pilot. Basically everyone. Really, people felt, they felt like real people.
Mm.
And I just really like the atmosphere.
Yeah, the visuals were really good, I thought.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I really dug it. I have a couple of questions.
Okay.
We're not done with questions.
No.
So droids.
Yep.
Like I mentioned, it's been a while since I saw the movies.
Yep.
And I can't remember, maybe this is already a thing, but... Mm. Were there always droids with an attitude? Were there always sassy droids?
Pretty
like
much.
Like this one?
I mean, droids, it's
kind of... I
don't
remember.
Wait, you mean like in the movies and stuff? Or?
Yeah.
It's kind of implied that R2-D2 has a sassy attitude based on C-3PO's responses to him.
Also, he has an accent. Mm-hmm. Why would they program him with an accent?
Yeah.
I don't know what which one. I can't distinguish accents, but I know he has one.
Yeah, I'd have to look up the actor. I assume he's just doing his own voice, but... I don't know if the Star Wars universe is supposed to be British, but it's had a history of casting British actors in a lot of it, and it's always, I think, usually filmed in Pinewood Studios in London.
I mean, I like the guy. It's just a little... It was a little... I'm probably just misremembering this, but I thought droids were a little drier.
Yeah,
this guy was sassy.
His reason for being sassy is he was an Imperial droid who they captured, reprogrammed, and it made him a little loopy, I guess.
Okay.
So he's not quite to protocol. He's...
No, it's space magic. It's all right. It's space magic.
Yeah, and like in other sources, the droids usually develop attitudes if they aren't memory wiped regularly. Yeah, it's like a personality develops over time the longer they're allowed to keep building their memories up.
I mean, it's cool.
Yeah.
Also, I know this is it's like a running gag that stormtroopers aim really badly.
Mm.
But is their armor made of paper mache?
Apparently.
They can't take a fucking hit in that they are fully armored. Why are they wearing armor? It doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
It doesn't hold off blaster shots. No, knock on the head. No, nothing.
I think it's supposed to look imposing, but otherwise, in practice, it doesn't seem like it protects against much. And the thing with the aim being terrible, I thought that was just because it's a movie and they're common bad guys and they need to die all the time.
I mean, they go down like flies.
Yeah, I mean, it's a movie cliche, and I thought it was just a movie thing, but there's actually, like, theories that it's the design of the helmet, like, because I assumed the helmet would have peripheral vision in addition to those two little eye slits, but if you try to actually wear a helmet like that with only those eye slits, you have no peripheral vision, you can't see shit. So I guess the theory is that, yeah, their helmets are just helmets, and they can't see anything.
Yeah, but I mean, wouldn't it actually be better for them to not wear the armor because they would be more dexterous and
yeah.
could move better? It's just a hindrance.
Well, I mean, the way the armor is designed, those black parts are just like a bodysuit and the white panels are the solid pieces of armor. So they're still flexible. They can move their joints. They've just got these white panels laying over everything.
Give them a uniform or something. That shit they're wearing, it doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
It's at what I don't know who. I think it was the monk. It just pushed someone.
Mm.
The husband, the monk's husband, threw someone into someone else, and they both knocked them both out with that. Just like that.
Yeah.
Your defense is not working, guys. Try something else. It's not working.
Yeah. Yeah, they're not superimposing.
And the third question, what's the difference between the white and the black stormtroopers?
Okay. Oh, yeah. Actually, that's a rant I was saving that I... it's not really a rant. It's just a quibble. Okay, so the black troopers, I guess, watching the movie, they're like elite guards working for Krennic. But in the toys, you find out that their name is called Death Troopers, which is kind of annoying for me. Well, because they're more similar to the Dark Troopers from the old canon, who were like half cyborg. I don't know if that's still true of these Death Troopers, if they're like part cyborg, and maybe that's why they're more competent than regular stormtroopers, because they've got robot parts that let them aim better. The problem I have with it is that Death Trooper is a reference to the Star Wars zombie novel. It was the first Star Wars horror book ever written. It's called Death Troopers. It's got this really cool cover of, it's like a stormtrooper helmet hooked, it's like a hook on a chain hanging from the ceiling. It's just hooked through the eye. There's like blood dripping out of it. It looks awesome. I'd love to get a poster of it. But it, it's a Star Wars zombie novel about, it's like this Imperial prison ship where a virus gets loose and starts zombifying people. So up until now, Death Trooper has always been used to refer to zombie troopers, but now they're using it to refer to these black armor people. Yeah, I mean, I guess what makes them different from regular stormtroopers is they know what they're doing.
Yeah, wouldn't it be better to just employ a lot of the black guys and none of the white guys?
Yeah, I don't know how much extra training it takes to get... Because I assume like stormtroopers are just like fresh out of the academy, you throw some armor on and make them patrol the streets. And like in some sources, it sounds like they might not even train them that well, because the Empire is just so confident in the thought that they control the galaxy that they just... I think the Ahsoka novel might have said something about like the stormtroopers are better at parade marching than at actual fighting, because they've just been trained to like march around in armor and be a symbol of the Empire, but you put them in combat and they don't really know what they're doing.
The stormtroopers are wearing that stuff actually only so that the good guys can steal it and get into facilities unrecognized.
Yeah,
that's why their armor looks like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because the Empire has weird priorities. Like, even the TIE fighters are... The whole idea of TIE fighter tactics is that you make a bunch of really cheap ships with no shields. They fly at higher... Like, X-Wings compared to TIE fighters, X-Wings have shields. X-Wings have hyperdrives. X-Wings have four cannons instead of two. I mean, like, X-Wings are just all around better ships, but the TIE fighters, I guess the reasoning is that they can mass produce these TIE fighters, train up a bunch of expendable pilots, and send them all flying out at once to swarm things. Which, I mean, like Sean was saying, you never really get that sense watching the classic movies that they actually have more TIE fighters. It seems like they're just, there's the same number of TIE fighters as X-Wings. You kind of get that more in Rogue One, I guess, since they had more of the budget and CG to be able to show stuff like that, that the Empire wins by overwhelming force and not necessarily because they have the best stuff. They could have better stuff. Yeah. They're just cheap and they decided to mass produce cheap stuff. Mm. I'm glad you liked the movie.
I really, really did. And I'm probably gonna watch episode 7. I wasn't planning on doing so.
Mm. Yeah, episode 7 is more fun in tone. But I think episode 7 had stronger characters, personally. Like, the leads are both really charming, entertaining people. The villain is also really good.
Mm. At the Star Wars Cantina, the weirdest creatures you've ever seen. Let's try this, if we can do it as well as he does.
Oh, we'll do our own outro?
Yeah.
We'll make him jealous that we did an outro without him. So this has been Funk Dunk, the After Hours questions. Kirsten, do you have any final thoughts?
I learned
more than you ever needed to know about Star Wars.
I learned a great many things. I'm gonna forget every single thing that we've talked about.
Oh, good. That'll make it fresh when I say it again in some future episode. If anyone has any Star Wars questions and you weren't bored to death by this, then please ask them in the thread. I'd be happy to answer any. Depending how much of this recording gets in, as I've said before, this has been my life. My sad, nerdy life for a while, so...
Oh.
I know lots of this stuff, and if you need book recommendations, I can either recommend my favorites, or if you give me some like topics and stuff you're interested in, like maybe a character that you like, I can find some good stories about them. I've got stuff. I got resources. I've got a whole book that's like a description of the plot summaries of every book. It was like written sort of out of universe. Like a lot of the reference books are in universe. This one's out of universe. It's written from like the perspective of a reader who wants to read these books. And like it just goes through every book that's been published and gives a short synopsis of it. So I can find stuff if you have a favorite character you're looking for.
Something I forgot to mention.
Hmm?
That I planned to mention. We have a winner. You know, last week, or for, sorry, 2 weeks ago, last week we played D&D. Two weeks ago, there was a quiz. What's the show called? And we have a winner.
Who? You do?
It's Carbax on YouTube. I'm not sure if we know this person under a different name. I'm pretty sure that I heard this name before. Carbax, you win. Of course, our show is called the BT Podcast.
All video are games all the time.
All Johnny, Austin, and Leon in the witness protection program. Because of word crimes, and yep. You discovered us. Your prize for winning is you get to listen.
Did you bring the prize?
Yeah, of course. You get to listen to next week's episode. Woo!
Ooh! You get to listen to it a week from now.
Yeah, exactly. So, congratulations, Carbax, and. You know, keep listening, I guess.
Yeah. This has been Leon, Austin, and Johnny with new voices.
You know, Leon is a little quiet today.
Mm. We had to put him down.
I don't know why that's funny.
Mm.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
It's Gorfmas time, tentacles and slime. Everyone scream, it's sacrifice time. Slaves on the altar are meat on the slab. Futures consumed as the victim we stab.